Good old-fashioned football weather today in New Haven, fitting for a rivalry that started back in 1875. This year's rendition of Harvard-Yale has high stakes in addition to historic pride. Yale is playing for an outright conference title. Old-school tradition meets here-and-now relevance for the 134th play of the game. Afternoon here at the Yale Bowl. Temperatures expected to get into the low 40s as TIAA presents the Ivy League Game of the Week, final game of the season for us, Harvard at Yale. Thanks for being with us. I'm Paul Burmeister, and welcome to the Yale Bowl. All season long, the parity in the Ivy League has been a headline here. In fact, just last week, we were talking about the possibility of seven Ivy League teams sharing the conference title. Well, a whole lot has changed in a week, and the biggest domino to fall happened last Saturday at Princeton. Yale, with this scene here, coming back from a 10-point halftime deficit to knock off the Tigers. That earned them at least a share of the conference title. A win today, and the celebration would be even sweeter because it would mean the conference title was theirs and theirs alone. Looking forward to the company of Ross Tucker throughout the afternoon. So Yale in very good position here, but a lot of folks at Columbia and also Dartmouth pretty interested in what's happening here.
Yeah, it's not over yet. Yale has at least a piece of it. They want the outright title badly, Paul. They have not gotten it since 1980. But folks in both Columbia and Dartmouth will be rooting extremely hard for Harvard to pull off the upset so they can get a piece of championship as well.
A year ago before this game, Yale came in with only two wins. What are the reasons why, the main reasons why they're in this spot now?
Well, let's talk about both of them. They have an excellent senior offensive line, but the quarterback, Kurt Rawlings, was the Ivy League Player of the Week last week. Look what he did after they fell behind 24-7. He was nearly perfect, Paul, when they needed him to be. That was huge. They also have a freshman running back in Zane Dudek who has absolutely taken the league by storm. You see that jump cut right there? He has such good vision. I mentioned the senior veteran-laden offensive line. He's a stud.
Third member of our team is Carolyn Mano. Here she is with Yale head coach Tony Reno.
Well, Coach, you come into the game as a favorite today, but we know that this particular matchup has its own set of rules. What's the message being enforced with your players this week about how to approach this game?
Well, you throw the records out when this game is, as we well know, especially from last year. So I mean, our biggest thing we've done all year is really just to continue to focus on winning plays and winning one game at a time, focus on 1 week at a time. And kids have done a nice job in practice, and they know this will be our biggest test yet.
Your run game has been well documented. What do you expect from Harvard defensively to try to slow the run down?
Well, I'm sure they're going to try everything they can to do that as well, as both teams will. You know, if you can eliminate the run from the game and force teams to throw the ball, you make them play one-handed. So I think we'll see that on both sides.
What's more important to this football team and to you, winning an outright championship for the first time since 1980 or simply beating Harvard today?
Both.
If you had to pick.
I can't pick. They're both important.
Coach, thank you.
Thank you.
And we are so used to Harvard being in the position here to play for a conference title. Not the case this year. They do have a winning record, but you can't deny it, Ross. They have taken a step back.
They have, and there's a bunch of reasons for that. They have some injuries. They've also been up and down at the quarterback position. You see Coach Murphy, unprecedented success they've had over the last 16 years. But he said it's been a very trying year. They've had to work for everything they've gotten. They've played two quarterbacks in almost every game, Paul. That's not a recipe for success. They will start the true freshman Jake Smith out of Central Michigan. We were impressed with what he did in the Princeton game earlier in the season. Very similar to a lot of the Harvard quarterbacks that have had success. He is equally dangerous with both his arms and his legs.
Getting to that time of year, Ross, where the tradition comes in. So many stadiums around the country, including here at the Yale Bowl. But how about this? They started playing this rivalry all the way back in 1875. This rendition for Yale has the possibility of an outright conference title for the first time in 37 years. Kickoff of the game on the other side of the break. We'll be right back. Yale Bulldogs led by their seniors coming out onto the field. A perfect 4-0 so far this season at home. Looking to get that last one against their arch rival, the Harvard Crimson. Head coach for Harvard is Tim Murphy. He's on the sideline with Carolyn Mano.
Paul, thank you. You come into this game, coach, for the first time in well over a decade without being in contention for the title. But how does that simplify things for you in terms of what this game is about?
Well, it's always about pride, any rivalry game. Pride in your school, your program, and your football team.
How significant is not having your running back, Charlie Booker, today?
Charlie's a great player. He's obviously one of the great backs in our league. But Champ and LJ, they'll be able to pick it up.
For you guys to be successful today, and we've seen in this matchup over the years that just about anything can happen, what will you need to do?
We'll need to be able to get off the field defensively. They've done a great job possessing the ball with their run game. Secondly, they're a high-risk, high-reward defense, so you've got to make some big plays.
Coach, thank you.
Thank you.
Paul?
Carolyn, coach, thank you very much. And so much history to consider when they started playing back in 1875. Ross, I think for what's happening here recently, you got to think about the fact that Harvard has won the last seven times they've been on this field.
They have, and you see last season at the bottom of the screen, that was huge. All the Yale students went on the field after the game, stormed the field because they had finally ended that streak. It's kind of weird that here we are the very next year and Yale actually comes into this game as the favorites.
You heard Tim Murphy mention to our Carolyn Mano just a moment ago that Charlie Booker will not be playing. He has an upper body injury. This is huge. Any team would miss its starting running back, but he's the number two rusher in the Ivy League.
Right, you could argue he's the best running back in the league. Certainly there are some other good ones as well as Zane Dudek. So instead, they're going to have to go with the freshman, Aaron Champlin. So we'll have two freshmen starting at running back in this game. You don't see that very often.
A couple of captains you see right there. Number 17 for Yale. Fantastic career he has had, Spencer Rimashevsky. And on the opposite side, number 35 was Luke Hutton, captain linebacker for Harvard. Just a bit ago, Ross talked about how Columbia, Dartmouth fans will be watching what's happening here today, because if those two teams win and Yale loses, we would have a three-way tie atop the Ivy League.
Right. You got to expect Columbia to get the win playing against Brown. Dartmouth and Princeton, I would think, would be a little bit more competitive. We'll see how that game plays out. But certainly Dartmouth and Columbia both favored in those games.
Getting all set for the 134th playing of the game, and it could have been colder. It could have been wet here, Ross. We're actually faring pretty well with the weather. It's dry, supposed to stay dry until the end of the game. Temperatures in the low 40s. Not bad football weather for the end of November.
No, it's perfect football weather, and just seeing all the cars piling in here 3 hours before the game, all of the tailgates, pretty much as far as the eye can see in every direction. It's truly unique as it relates to Ivy League football. There's a reason why they call it the game.
And it's nice to see that flag doing what it's doing. It's not very much. Both the quarterbacks, the freshman Jake Smith and Kurt Rawlings for Yale, will appreciate that anytime they go to throw. Although we do expect the Yale offense to come out running. Zane Dudek, top rusher in the Ivy League, getting ready to come on the field for the first time. Ross, truly amazing what Yale has done to get to this point. When you consider a year ago, they came in with only a pair of wins, pulled off the upset. They've lost only one time this year by 1 point to Dartmouth, outscored their opponents by more than 100 points in four games here at the Yale Bowl. Here we go, the game for the 134th time. Rouse will take a knee, and the Yale offense will begin with a touchback. And Ross, let's take a peek now at today's starting lineups presented by TIAA, beginning with the Yale offense.
They are really led by their offensive line, and they're so excited to get John Besney, the big right tackle, back. He missed last week's game against Princeton, but he's back in the lineup today. And at wide receiver, the running game gets most of the credit, but CeeLo, they call him, Chris Williams-Lopez, had 11 big catches against Princeton last week, and that come from behind victory.
Number six is Kurt Rawlings. He's the reigning Ivy League Player of the Week. To his right, Zane Dudek leads the Ivy League in rushing. And Rawlings keeps it himself just out across the 25-yard line. And Yale begins with a gain of six. The Harvard defense starting lineups presented by TIAA.
always so good up front is Harvard. Defensive tackle Richie Ryan was the Ivy League Defensive Player of the Week against Columbia. Luke Hutton is their senior captain. And on the back end, Tanner Lee coming off an unbelievable game last week against Penn. 10 tackles, a forced fumble, an interception, and a pass defensed.
Graham in motion. And penalty markers come in.
False start. Offense, number 61. 5-yard penalty. Replay, second down.
And maybe that's Besney showing a little bit of rust after missing last week. They had to actually bounce Sterling Strother, the starting center today, out to right tackle. So they had to move some guys around with Besney out. Coming off that leg injury, we'll have to see how he performs, how he moves today.
Don't be surprised at all to see number 33, Zane Dudek, get his first carry of the game. The only rusher in the Ivy League over 1,000 yards. And there he is off the right side. And there's the Harvard defense there to make a stop to bring up third down and 5.
Carolyn asked Tony Reno a good question before the game about Harvard trying to load up to stop the run. The problem is everybody's done that. And no one really has had that much success. Your best bet, though, and it's in part because of the Besney penalty, is to get them in these third and long situations where they have to throw. You kind of take Dudek out of the picture, although he is a pretty accomplished receiver out of the backfield also.
Rawlings pretty accomplished himself when it comes to throwing, 67% right now, the best ever at Yale for a single season. Nice pocket to stand in, and the Harvard defense right away producing a 3-and-out.
Harvard loves to play zone coverage and keep everything in front of them, Paul. That's exactly what they did there. There was nowhere to go. And the Harvard defense gets this game off to a great start with a 3-and-out. And they should get pretty good field position. They have the best punt returner in all of FCS football, Justice Shelton Mosley. Almost 19 yards of return. We'll see what Yale's strategy is to try to keep the ball away from number 17.
Maybe kicking the ball out of bounds. This one right to him calls for the fair catch, and the Harvard offense will begin from its own 38-yard line. Justice Shelton Mosley coming off a game 2 years ago here at the Yale Bowl, over 100 yards receiving and also a couple of receiving touchdowns. Let's take a look at today's starting lineups for the Harvard offense presented by TIAA.
Pretty much the entire offensive line will be back next year, led in part by junior Tim O'Brien. The left tackle might be the next Harvard offensive lineman to get a chance at the next level. Aaron Champlin, Coach Murphy told us he is going to be an excellent, excellent player in this league, only a freshman.
Tony Reno telling us during the week right away in our conversation his top concern with his team was stopping the run game. Well, they're without their top runner in Charlie Booker. It's all on Aaron Champlin. Smith right away to the air. Coming underneath, Justice Shelton Mosley. Harvard first down inside of Yale territory. Shoved out of bounds by Spencer Rimashevsky. That's a gain of 21.
Well, Yale came with a blitz. You see both linebackers blitz. It's picked up. Yale plays almost exclusively man-to-man coverage, which is not easy for Rimashevsky to have to try to stay with a guy like Shelton Mosley on those crossing patterns, and Harvard's already in Yale territory.
Pushing the pace, Champlin off the left side, and brought down at the 40-yard line, and get used to this name, Foya Aluakon, the senior linebacker.
He has had an unbelievable season. Finally playing linebacker after playing safety so long, he has really taken to it. He has rare speed and athleticism for the second level. He is one of a couple of Yale defenders that are very likely to at least get some opportunity at the next level.
One of 7 seniors starting on defense for Yale. Smith stands in, second catch of the day for Justice Shelton Mosley. Be about a yard short of a first down. Let's take a look at the Yale starting defense presented by TIAA.
The D-line has gotten after people all season, including Kyle Mullen, who has 4.5 sacks. We mentioned Foye Aluakon. Matt Opplinger, number 22, has been outstanding. On the back end, Hayden Carlson is the leading tackler for the Bulldogs, 12th all-time in school history.
And that was just enough for a Harvard first down, their second of their opening possession. First and 10 from the 31. Champlin up the middle. Got just across the 30. Before he met the heart of that Yale defense, gain of about 3 yards. So Yale defensively in the Ivy League, you see a lot of firsts there. A lot of coaches say it doesn't get more important than rushing yards and preventing points, and they're number one in both of those spots.
And to think that they're number one in all those categories, even though they gave up over 500 yards of offense and 31 points to Princeton last week, that tells you a little bit about just how good they've been this season.
Another short gain for Champlin of one to bring up third down. In a passing situation, Justin Shelton Mosley already with two catches today, Ross.
And it looks like Spencer Rimashevsky, number 17, is going to pretty much travel with Shelton Mosley wherever he goes. So that matchup, 17 against 17 at the top of the screen, is one to keep an eye on. This also could be four down territory, Paul, so don't be surprised if maybe Smith, the quarterback, runs it on this play.
Shelton Mosley told us Rimashevsky was the best corner he played against as a freshman here 2 years ago. Doesn't have him that time. Shelton Mosley inside the 10-yard line. It'll be first and goal, Crimson. Gain of 18.
Yeah, if Jake Smith, the freshman, is going to get this much time, they're not going to be able to stay with Shelton Mosley. He's just too quick. You got a linebacker trying to cover him that time in zone coverage, Ronnie Meter, at 245 pounds. That's asking a lot. Terrific game plan from Harvard to start this game with these crossing patterns to Shelton Mosley.
Three receptions, Shelton Mosley, first and goal. This is Champlin, and he's brought down at the 8-yard line. Shelton Mosley told us during the week that with that man coverage, he was looking forward to a lot of big play opportunities.
He is, and we're already seeing guys fall down, Paul. We're already seeing guys fall down. You see number 66, the left guard, Matt Jones. Look at the jerseys, too. It is a very muddy field down there. It's not easy to get traction. That's going to be a factor also.
Play action to Champlin. And that's looked like a face mask as Smith went down, but a couple of penalty markers down to the backfield.
They're going to get Earl Chisholm, the senior D end, reaching out to try to get a piece of Jake Smith.
Personal foul, face mask, defense, number 48. Half the distance from the previous spot, automatic, first down.
Take a look right there, you'll see Earl Chisholm right there. He's going to come unblocked. And Champlin, the freshman, actually goes out there, tries to get a piece right there. Yeah, he might have got him with both hands. He might have done the double dip there. And Harvard, hey, you want to get an upset victory on the road? Your first drive, first and goal inside the five. You got to get a touchdown here.
Champlin remains the tailback to the left of Jake Smith.
Smith can run. Both Harvard quarterbacks can.
First time out, 30 seconds.
You know, the Harvard Crimson didn't score a single touchdown in a loss last week to Penn, but on their first drive, Jake Smith, Justice Shelton Mosley hot. It'll be first and goal from inside the five when we come back.
You can make it if you try.
No score at the Yale Bowl yet, but freshman quarterback Jake Smith has the Crimson on the move. And last week, no touchdowns, the first time in 20 seasons that's happened to Harvard.
That's an incredible stat. And if they score right here against the best defense in the Ivy League, it makes it even more impressive. They got four downs to do it, too.
Three receptions for Justice Shelton Mosley, leading the way for 48 yards. And the inside sweep, and he's dropped in the backfield. That's Mullen there to greet him.
Harvard getting a little cute here, trying to bring Shelton Mosley around, almost like a speed sweep. Nobody blocked Kyle Mullen. I don't know if Champlin was supposed to block him or not, or maybe that was a read play and Smith should have pulled the ball. Either way, it did not work.
Awfully stingy in the red zone, the best in the Ivy League. Mullen, one of the juniors, starting alongside seven seniors on that Yale D. This is Champlin in trouble off the right side, goes down to the 10-yard line. Matthew Opplinger, help from his senior linebacker, Foya Eluakon.
Opplinger and Eluakon have been so good. Champlin bounces it outside right away. Might have had something behind the center to the left. One of the differences all young running backs have to see is just the speed at the second level. Both Opplinger and Eluakon can really, really run.
Big plays by Mullen, then Eluakon and Opplinger, and now it's third down and goal from the 10-yard line for Harvard. Bulldogs bring four and get to him with four. John Harubin with a sack for Yale.
Things went south for Harvard after that timeout. They had it rolling. It feels like they lost all the momentum. Certainly got a little too cute there on that first down run, and right there, things just caved in on freshman quarterback Jake Smith. Tried to use his legs, but unable to get past the grips of Harubin.
First and goal from just inside the five. The front seven, the Bulldogs living in the backfield on first, second, and third down is Jake McIntyre from 29 yards out. And Harvard comes away with three.
You almost got to feel like that's a win, though, if you're Yale. For Harvard to be that far down and the Yale defense to step up when they needed to save 4 points for their team.
We hope you've enjoyed all of our coverage this week as we celebrate the game 2020. Tonight's broadcast takes us to 2017, a very momentous day at the bowl, and despite the slow start to things, we'll get cranked up here shortly. So before all the fun begins, we want to take this time to talk to the head coach of the Bulldogs, Tony Reno. And coach, this 2017 game, does it get any better than this?
Thanks, Evan. Appreciate being on. So that team was a special team, obviously. They were the Ivy League champions. They clinched it the week before at Princeton, or at least a share of it at Princeton. And I walked into the team meeting on Sunday. It was this team's opportunity to have a part of the championship under their belt. And I walked into the team meeting and I listed the things on the board they could control and they couldn't. And I looked into the group and he looked right at me and said, "Hey, coach, we're not done yet." And that was the feeling on the team was, hey, it was nice to clinch a piece of it at Princeton, but, it doesn't mean anything unless we win this one. And that was how they treated it, how they prepared for it all week, and then how they played on Saturday.
This game in particular was a chance to do something that sadly hadn't been done in a long time, and that was win a game against a team up north at home.
Sure, yeah, it had been quite some time. 1999, I think, previous to this game, was the last time Yale had won. It was, obviously far too long. Us to be able to play at home in the bowl on kind of a gray day, kind of dreary gray day. It was one of the last. It was actually, I think, the last Yale team up north game on the grass in the bowl. And so the bowl grass was at its finest. We called it at that point the sandbox because it was all different shades of dirt. The kids played incredibly well. And the game started off where our opponent had a really good opening drive and kicked a field goal, and then from that point on we really controlled the game.
The big play that sticks out from this game, and we'll talk about it later with our other guest, a second quarter scoop and score for a touchdown by Malcolm Dixon, and really never again was the result in doubt.
No, I think when you looked at the field position battle, we were able to really win the field position battle, and that was one of the drives where we were able to, keep them and their own side of the field. And there was an option play to their sideline, and it was one of those plays where it just the the pitch wasn't quite what the relationship with the back, and just didn't, you know, wasn't exactly what I'm sure what they wanted. And the ball ended up on the ground, and you know, Malcolm Dixon and Micah Awodiran did a great job of securing the fumble, and Malcolm ran in for a touchdown. And you know, from that point on, we were able to really get a foothold.
All fall, we have talked about the senior leadership and talent of this 2017 team. But in this game, you can see kind of the passing of the torch to the younger players that made a lot of big plays in this edition of the game.
Yeah, they did. I mean, we mentioned Micah, you know, Malcolm Dixon, who was a sophomore in that game. Micah was a freshman in that game. You know, Kurt Rawlings, J.P. Shofi had some big plays in that game. You know, Dieter Eiselin and Sterling Schroeder played well in that game. You know, and you look at the team that we just had this past season, 2019, a lot of those names are the guys who were seniors. And one of the things that senior class did an incredible job of was they really handled their legacy well. And, you know, they did a nice job of bringing the younger guys along. And, you know, that's what was one of the benefits we had this past season because of that 17 team.
At the end of the game, the family nature of Yale football is in full display. Players of the past joining the current players, they celebrate the win and the championship here in 2017. And it's a true example of what makes this Yale football family so special.
It really is, Evan. I mean, I think one of the things that you know, makes Yale unique, and every school has its things, but what makes us unique is the ability to have relationships with each other and the meaningfulness of them. So within our football family, you know, there's a genuine care for each other, of our alums who've played, you know, in previous times, to our guys who play today, those who played, you know, a long time ago. I mean, everyone really cares about each other and wants to be there for each other and celebrate with each other, but also bring each other along when there's moments of adversity. It was really a great moment to be able to celebrate that championship on the field with many of those men.
Coach, we thank you for all your time this season. It's been an incredible journey, not only this week, but all fall long, to see the triumphs of all of these different eras of Yale football. And this 2017 game is up near the top, but we will probably get to see the top tomorrow in our coverage.
Thanks, Evan. I really appreciate you doing this.
That was Tony Reno, the Joel E. Smilo 54 head coach of Yale football. He's been a core part of our 2020 football coverage, and we thank him for all his time this year. The game, 2017, continues now. So let's go back to the Yale Bowl, to Paul Burmeister, Ross Tucker, and Carolyn Mano.
She's on the field. She bounced right back up, which is good. There's two penalties. That might be a big break for Harvard.
Fouls on the play. Holding. Offense, number 53. Holding. Defense, number 23. Those fouls offset. Still first down.
Let's do first down again.
Yeah, that's huge for Harvard because they got O'Brien, the big left tackle, for the hold. And then Yale really didn't need Foye Oluokun to hold in the secondary. So instead of it being first and 20, it's right back to first and 10.
If you're just joining us, it's the 134th playing of the game. Harvard without its top rusher, the number two rusher in the Ivy League, and Charlie Booker. Adam Shamplin getting his carries. Smith out of the backfield. To his tight end, Stusel. That's a gain of four.
Hayden Carlson, watch 26 come flying from the middle of your screen. He has been so good his entire career. He's in man-to-man coverage there, and as soon as he saw Stansel go under the formation, he just attacked it. You cannot hesitate at all.
Led the Ivy League in tackles in 2015, the current active leader in the entire conference in that category. Second down, six.
They're showing man coverage and blitz here again, Paul.
Run it right up the middle. Levance Northington, the backup running back, with Charlie Booker out. That's a gain of two. You mentioned aggressive defense. That's what they're playing right now. The majority of the time at Yale, I talked to Tony Reno at practice on Wednesday. He said they've adopted it after Michigan, the Michigan style. Don Brown, the D coordinator there, spent time here at Yale. Said it's great for recruiting. These kids come in and want to play that kind of defense, but if you don't get to the quarterback, it can leave a receiver like Shelton Mosley open.
Well, you can give up big plays, too. Princeton had a bunch of them last week against Yale.
Let me rush four this time. Smith gets rid of it late, just fires it away.
Good coverage by Yale on that series. Smith couldn't find anyone. Looked to me like he might have had a little bit of room to try to run and maybe get the first down. I don't know if he would have had enough room there on the edge, but he's rolling right at this point, which takes Henry Taylor, who you see double covered, some other guys totally out of the picture.
Number 19 is Jason Alessi. Starter, one of the best players in the spring for the Ivy League champion lacrosse team. Also a starter at safety and their punt returner. And the senior from Bloomfield Hills, Michigan. Fair catch at his own 9-yard line. Yale offense back on the field trailing 3-0 when we come back to the Yale Bowl. Yale win last Saturday at Princeton wasn't any type of win. They trailed 14-0 at one point. A furious second half comeback would follow.
Kurt Rawlings to Ross Drawl, then Zane Dudek finishing a drive off like he's done so many times, and then the celebration was on. You know, that said, Paul, as great as last week was and this season's been, it would really damper what they've accomplished if you lose today. I mean, you lose to your rival and you lose the chance to win the outright championship.
First down and 10 for Kurt Rawlings, just inside his own 10-yard line. Looking for his second completion, has it to J.P. Schofi. First down, Bulldogs. Let's go to the Yale sideline and check in with Carolyn Mano.
Well, thanks, Paul. You and Ross both know how intense head coach Tony Reno is. He doesn't say much, but what he says matters. And he's really preaching physicality, intensity, and telling the sidelines to get very involved. You know, he preaches relationships, Ross and Paul, players and players, coaches and coaches, in addition to coaches and players. And he wants a little bit more intensity down here from the sidelines as they look to get some momentum.
Carolyn, thank you. Mainly wanting some production from his offense. That was the first down of the game for them. That's Melvin Rouse off the left side.
Yeah, just playing amateur psychologist, Paul, and you played football at a high level as well. You know, Yale's season was made last week by winning a piece of the championship. But Harvard has to win this game to have something positive coming out of this. I mean, this a win today would make Harvard's season. And for Yale, they want to win just as much, and they want to beat their rivals and have a chance to beat, you know, be the outright champion. It's just not quite the same, and I feel like you can see that so far in this game.
I feel that sense of urgency coming out on their sideline. That's well overthrown by Kurt Rawlings. And a theme here now in the first quarter, we're going to see it again, third down and long for the Yale offense.
Harvard defense is playing fantastic. Look at that, by the way. 7 wins every year since 2001. They will not get there this year. Head coach Tim Murphy during the week told us it's the greatest bull market in Ivy League football history. He's right. He's right. I mean, it's ridiculous that they've had that kind of consistency. Tony Reno, the Yale coach, said, hey, that's what we're all shooting for. It's unbelievable that they've been this good for this long.
16 seasons in a row, 7 wins or more, never been done in the history of the Ivy League, and it ends right there at 17. 3rd and 7. Rawlings underneath, and that's...
he lost it.
That's a fumble. It's being ruled down. Being ruled down at the 35-yard line. Ross Drawl lost it after he was down.
Let's take a look. There's no replay in the Ivy League. He bobbled it. Ooh, man, I don't know. As he was going down, it looked to me like Tanner Lee ripped that ball out. Let's see if the elbow or a knee gets down before that ball gets ripped out. Whew. I don't know. That first angle we saw, it didn't look like it, but it is immaterial here in the Ivy League.
As you mentioned, Ross, no replay. So it's first down, Yale. Zane Dudek off the right side just across the 40-yard line for a gain of 5.
That feels like a gigantic first down for Yale. You know, throw the ball short of the sticks and have draw power through to get that first down on third and seven. Maybe Yale can finally get the offense going now a little bit.
See if they can get the number one rusher in the Ivy League, Dudek, involved a little more here. Play action, penalty marker comes in just as the ball was snapped.
Yale's been hurt by penalties so far in this game. False starts.
False start. Offense, number 88. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
A lot of penalties at the beginning of the season. We've seen even more here today, Ross. When I was at practice Wednesday, I walked down the tunnel with a referee, all dressed up, an official. Once a week, they have a ref come to practice. And that started because there were so many yellow flags at the beginning of the season. They tried to clean it up during practice, although they're not off to a good start that way today.
No, three false start penalties and a critical hold against Aluakun as well.
Rawlings from a nice pocket, throws into coverage. Two Crimson defenders there, and the ball was knocked down. Tanner Lee leading the charge, letting you know. And another third and long. This will be third and 10.
Rawlings had all kinds of time, threw a jump ball for Siragusa, and there was definitely a bump between Rawlings and Siragusa. Wow, there's a body bump there.
Potential pull by Rayshon McGee as well.
Right, but I think I like the no call there just because it looked like Tanner Lee was going for the ball as he jumped up in the air to bat it down. When in doubt, don't throw the flag.
They just had third and seven, and Rawlings to Schofield got him the first down. Pardon me, Rawlings to draw. Underneath now, that's Schofi, and that is Tanner Lee dropping him at the 38-yard line.
Tanner Lee is everywhere right now. I mean, this is unbelievable. That's three plays in a row. He's ripping the ball out. He's making the tackle. He's batting the ball down. Coming off of what he did last week, they tried to throw it underneath and hoped that Schofi would be able to maybe get the first down like Drawl did, but Tanner Lee was having nothing of it. That's Harvard defense right there, third and 10. Play zone, let you catch it in front of them, and then come up and body rock you with the tackle.
Led the defense last week with 10 tackles against Penn and off to a strong start here today. Top punt returner in the Ivy League won't get his hands on that one. With all the deals, drama, and dough, there really is no place on it. No place like it on Earth. Shark Tank, weeknights starting 7 Eastern on CNBC. Get yours.
There was a Yale football player on that recently. Nate Lowry, the former tight end who played in the NFL for a little bit. He was on there.
How'd he do?
He did well. They gave him $250,000 for part of the company.
That counts as doing well.
He was happy. He took the deal. Look at that, by the way, Paul. Probably not what probably pretty much what you'd expect, actually, if you're thinking about Harvard, Yale, Princeton, Ivy League schools.
Wow. The defense had a couple of bad moments early in this game, but for the most part, looking the part of the top defense in the Ivy League. Tough pitch there. And brought down another nice tackle, Jason Alessi, from his safety position. Yale defense good on the perimeter here today.
Nice job by Champlin just to catch that. And look at Aluakun's athleticism, by the way. Aluakun had the quarterback there in the option. Then he changes direction and get down the line. That's a 235-pound linebacker getting down there to get a piece of the play if Alessi hadn't been able. And look at the mud starting to get on these guys' helmets and in their cleats.
Second down, 8. Smith in trouble in the pocket, goes down.
This is Yale defense, Paul. This is what they've done all year. See, Opplinger gets in there. A couple other guys help finish it as well. Opplinger, 22, though, just knocks Tim O'Brien, the left tackle, out of the way.
Matthew Opplinger leading the Ivy League in tackles for loss. And that's going to do it for the first quarter. Jake Smith, Justice Shelton Mosley made up all kinds of ground early in the first quarter through the air for the Crimson. Both defenses come into play. Good snapshot right there as Jake Smith goes down in the pocket. One quarter in the books, Harvard by three. Welcome back to the Yale Bowl. Second quarter set to begin with Harvard on top 3-0. That's Tony Reno, head coach for Yale in the center. Perhaps the biggest reason his team will have at least a share of the Ivy League title is that turnaround you see with the defense.
It's unbelievable. There's a couple reasons for it, Paul. Number one, a lot of these guys have been playing 2, 3, 4 years. Plus, they got a couple guys back that missed last season. Number 96, Kapachi Tyler, and 17, their captain, Spencer Rimashevsky.
From last in scoring D to first this year. Third down and 15. That's a completion, but well short of the first down. The Yale defense, after a tough start, coming back here now.
They really are. It's been a nice, nice job that they've done. On third and 15, too, to keep him in front. That's a freshman right there. Micah Awodiran, terrific job. You see some of the freshmen that they have, too. Some of the athleticism coming up. He's sort of the prototypical linebacker, the next Foye Oluokun, maybe.
You hear a lot about adjustments, about the adjustment by the Yale defense early. Justice Shelton Mosley had three catches on that first scoring drive and hasn't touched it since. Alessi lets that one roll down to the 31-yard
line.
And now the Yale offense, see if it can put points on the board for the first time. And we just talked about the defensive turnaround for Yale. Offensively, though, Ross, we were here a little over a year ago on a night against Penn when they really struggled to score, scored a late touchdown that didn't mean much. They go from 20 points a game last year to nearly 36 this year.
I mean, look at the last two numbers. More than 2 yards per carry and a third of the sacks. It's really been an incredible turnaround. And both coaches, Tony Reno and Tim Murphy, talked about, you know, last year's game, last year's upset win for Yale being the springboard.
Rouse, a slot receiver slash running back, gets that carry to the 33-yard line. And when you think about how far the Yale offense has come, Ross, in one season, so important that they had stability at quarterback to start the season. Remember, Rawlings didn't become the guy until the end of last year, and I think that really affected what happened in September and part of October.
I don't think there's any doubt about it. You see Sterling Strother, the center, heavily recruited offensive lineman, had a bunch of Pac-10 offers, elected to come here and be a part of what they're building at Yale.
Two backs in the backfield again. Rawlings flushed out of the pocket to his left. Going to keep it himself and brought down at the 36-yard line. Charlie Walker with the tackle after a gain of two.
Boy, that's a nice open field tackle by Walker. You see, Rawlings didn't like it. He can run. He's an athlete. Gets into space, and Walker right there. That is really, really well done. That is not easy. The junior from Texas, he's the lightest of the Harvard linebackers. Really plays that will linebacker. You know, the way college football is now, Paul, your outside linebackers are like safeties used to be. They really need to be able to cover. They really need to be able to run. And Walker fits that mold.
Third and five. We'll see if Rawlings can find his top receiver, Williams Lopez, who's yet to catch a ball today. He's in the slot to his right. Instead, underneath.
He's short.
And that's easily a yard short to Siragusa.
He tried to just throw a little crossing pattern like Harvard's been doing. It was just a little bit behind Siragusa. Maybe if he let him, he might have been able to make the play. But even so, Hutton was right there, ready to light him up. And Harvard holds again.
Ross, I wouldn't have been surprised to see him go. They're 8 out of 10 on fourth downs this year. Easily number one in the Ivy League, but still they are on their own 40-yard line.
Got to really watch the ball here if you're Harvard. Any type of hard count, can't afford a false start.
See if Justice Shelton Mosley gets a shot at his first return today. His third fair catch is the result, and the Crimson offense will begin from its own 18-yard line. 134th playing of the game. Lots of defense so far.
Welcome back to the Yale Bowl, everybody. You think about what makes up a really good football player: strength and toughness and determination, grit, and a whole lot of heart. And the toughest football player on this field is under the age of 10. His name is Dante Chipeta, and he was signed by Yale back in 2014 with the help of Team Impact, which pairs children with life-threatening illnesses with collegiate programs around the country. And Dante was diagnosed as a small child with something called cortical visual impairment and cerebral palsy, which basically means that his brain didn't understand the images that it was seeing. But if you talk to head coach Tony Reno, he says Dante is their rock. He means so much to this group. In fact, the spring game, Paul and Ross, this year, they organized it so that Dante could score his first career collegiate touchdown. He means the world to this group, and he's here supporting them today.
Well, it's a great story, Carolyn. It's an awesome program. I know the quarterback coach, Kevin Cahill, even ran the Boston Marathon in part to raise funds for Team Impact. Really cool.
It went very well with Carolyn's words, the shot there of Spencer Rimashevsky, exchanging a hug with him in the tunnel before the game. Well done. First down and 10 for the Harvard offense. Smith is 5 out of 6 and wanted Adam Scott there. He'll bring up second down and 10. We talked about it during the week on the conference call with the coaches for Harvard, Ross, that Adam Scott has had a nice season, but hey, the numbers are down from last year.
Well, last year he had an unbelievable year. And really, I think even Shelton Mosley's numbers are a little bit down.
Yes, they are.
It feels like they've given the ball to Shelton Mosley more. Scott has become almost a forgotten man at times. We'll see if Harvard tries to get back to those crossing patterns with Shelton Mosley.
He had 3 of them for 48 yards on the first drive. Champlin bottled up in the backfield. Does a nice job of getting outside. Could have been a big loss, and some speed and some effort around the right side salvaged that one for Harvard still. That'll bring up third down and long.
Boy, both these freshman running backs are so put together. Very impressive physically. Tried to get a block there from Jake Smith, but able to just make sure he didn't lose yardage, and ouch. Looks like someone got hit on the sideline again.
Tough on the sideline there. Second time we've seen that today. Whistles to stop play. And you can see.
Yeah, it looks like up at the top of your screen, up there, they're showing her.
Third down and 10. And this is Shelton Mosley around the left side, and that is the Yale defense having none of it. Aluakon from his linebacker spot, and also Hayden Carlson, the safety.
Conservative call by Harvard, but the way this game's going so far, Paul, it looks like it'll be a low-scoring game. Keep the clock moving and see if maybe your best athlete can make a play in space. Not able to do it. Gives Harvard a little bit of more room before this punt.
The Harvard offense, since that initial field goal producing drive, done nothing. And now Jason Alessi back to receive. Fair catch just inside of Harvard territory at the 49-yard line. The NASCAR championship will be decided tomorrow in Miami. Will Martin Truex Jr. win his first title? Or will former champions Kyle Busch, Kevin Harvick, or Brad Keselowski come away with the crown? Don't miss Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s final race tomorrow, 3 Eastern, only on NBC.
Well, it's the best field position for Yale so far. Let's see if they can do something with it.
Kurt Rawlings coming off an Ivy League Player of the Week performance. 26 out of 34 last week at Princeton. In that come-from-behind win, and that's Dudek. Top runner in the Ivy League has had a tough time getting going. Picks up 1 yard.
There's nothing there. I mean, there is just nothing there for Dudek right now. Take a look at the bottom of your screen. He goes out there and is blocking on the last series. Went out after that play. Might have been a little shaken up. That's the play where Rawlings was tackled in the open field by Charlie Walker.
Here's Dudek again, and once again, Ross, it's the Harvard defensive line there to greet him.
Boy, they have come to play. Chase Guillory, number 45, among the guys in there. He identifies that, then Charlie Walker comes in. Both linebackers there up to the task. I mean, you talk about a guy that's averaging close to 8 yards a carry. 7.9 in all of FCS football, yet Guillory in this Harvard front seven has kept him in check. You look at Harvard right now, everybody's back near the sticks, Paul. They're going to be in zone coverage again and let Yale complete it in front of them and make the tackle if Yale tries to do that again.
They're just 1 for 5 on third down. And now 1 for 6 with a turnover. Luke Hutton from his linebacker position.
Running,
with that pick.
Yeah, running down the seam against the tight end, Jaden Graham. The ball's just a little underthrown. But Hutton's with him stride for stride. What a play. The senior defenders for Harvard have come to play. Tanner Lee, Hutton, Guillory, they are playing their butts off so far.
Ross, as a quarterback, if you see a linebacker running with your tight end, you take that every single time. And what a job there by the captain, Hutton. Not only staying close, but coming up with the pick.
Well, we had a camera in the Harvard locker room before the game, and he was fired up, as was Tanner Lee. Not suitable for air, but they were fired up, that's for sure.
Rawlings, 5 completions for only 32 yards. Dudek, 5 rushes for only 14. Now it's the Yale defense.
Whoa, dangerous.
Wow. Shelton Mosley barely coming up with that one, and Jake Smith kind of dodged the bullet there.
They're going to have to take a shot, Paul, because Yale likes to play press man coverage. They're up there. They're up there on him. He's lucky that Dixon, number one, wasn't looking at the ball.
Wow.
That could have been a horrific interception. Everything for Yale is just so compressed. It's actually the opposite of what we're seeing defensively from Harvard, that Harvard's going to have to take a shot offensively. Look at the corner. Look at Krzyzewski at the bottom, right up there on him.
Jake Smith, you talked about top of the broadcast, Ross, that he would keep it himself and run and look good doing it. Pushes it out across the 15-yard line there. A gain of 7.
He needs to do more. He needs to do more of that running the ball, I think. Yeah, you look at that, the first Harvard freshman to start since Ryan Fitzpatrick. Wonder what that guy's doing now. I'll tell you what he's doing. He's starting against the Miami Dolphins tomorrow for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. That's what he's doing. And guess what? Knowing him, I can almost guarantee he's watching this game as well.
See what the freshman Jake Smith can do now on 3rd down and 4. Had a nice pocket. And had that ball broken up by Hayden Carlson. One of 3 senior starters in the defensive backfield for Yale.
He did have as much time as he wanted. People are just struggling to get open. And I really think the lack of footing is part of it. There was nowhere to go with that football.
Yale defense comes through again. And we really see, you talked about the muddy field, and defense is playing so well, go along pretty. Match up very nicely with an old school muddy field as both of these offenses struggling so far. Jason Alessi, fair catch on his own 46-yard line. See how the Yale offense can do here when we come back to the Yale Bowl for the game.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms. where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
That senior captain linebacker for Harvard, Luke Hutton, a couple of moments ago had the interception. Well, here he is before the game. And this just keeps going. He keeps getting a little more wound up, a little more excited. And there's a reason you're not hearing it. But that's how fired up he was pregame.
Well, I can attest to this, Paul. Ivy League's kids swear too, okay? Even though they go to great schools, Ivy League kids can swear as well. And he's truly unique talking with him this week. He's an econ major, but he wants to get into coaching. He's going to be a GA somewhere next year. You don't often hear Ivy League kids say that. Never gonna. He doesn't want to go into the quote-unquote workforce. He wants to go right into coaching. He said he thinks he can have a bigger impact on kids' lives that way.
Out of Austin, Texas, and the leading tackler on this team, Rawlings, with a strike to J.P. Shofi inside the 10-yard line. There's the big play they've been waiting for.
It starts with great protection. It's just a post route by Shofi. He gets behind the linebacker, and it looked like the safety, Tim Hale, had eyes for someone else. Good design there, because Hale, the safety, was looking at the other Yale receiver. Tremendous speed, by the way, by the freshman Winfield to chase him down.
45 yards, Rawlings to Shofi, first and goal, Yale. Dudek lost his footing and goes down to the 11-yard line.
That's happened a bunch. He's known for his stopping and starting ability, his ability to make jump cuts. But I'm telling you, Paul, being on the field before the game, the footing here, watch, it just gives out on him. And you can see that was a muddy patch right there. He had the right cut there. He would have gone for some decent yardage.
Dudek averaging less than 3 yards per carry so far. Ross, you talked about it, came in averaging 8 yards per carry. The only time this season he was under five was their lone loss against Dartmouth. Second and goal, Dudek with it, tries to get around that left side. Does a nice job fighting to get back to the original line of scrimmage to bring up third and goal.
This is a tremendous effort so far by Harvard's front seven. It really is, because even there, initially it looked like Dudek had some. They pulled the left tackle, Marbach, he was out in front. But Harvard just kept stringing it out.
Still haven't seen a reception for the top receiver for Yale, 84, Christopher Williams-Lopez. He's to the right of Rawlings.
Harvard showing pressure here. Let's see if they back out of it.
Goes to his left to the end zone. J.P. Shofi, touchdown, Yale.
Just man-to-man coverage. Shofi working against the freshman Wingfield. He beats him at the line. Rawlings puts the ball perfectly over the outstretched hands of Wingfield, and that was the J.P. Shofi drive.
And Yale will do this on the extra points. They line up, scattered across the field, and now they all come together in what appears to be the traditional attempt for an extra point. Alex Gallen up and in, and the Bulldogs lead for the first time 7-3. J.P. Shofi, 45-yard reception to get him inside the 10, and that's how he gets him inside the end zone. Bulldogs by 4. Good look back at the history here. Started in 1875. About 1894, they played at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Probably didn't cost a whole lot to get into that game, Ross.
So awesome. The history. The first crowd of over 80,000 people at an American sporting event was for the game in 1920. First onside kick in 81. Boy, that had to be a surprise, huh?
I mean, right?
First like, ever onside kick. What the heck was that? You're allowed to do it. Check the rule book.
Oh, man. And that first time they did it, Ross, 1875, 50 cents to get into the game. J.P. Schofie touchdown from Kurt Rollins. Makes it 7-3. And this is Adam Scott picking his way until Jason Alessi, senior safety, drops him at the 22-yard line.
That's why Alessi's on the kickoff team right there. Because you're going against guys like Adam Scott and Justice Shelton Mosley, and you want one of your best athletes, one of your best open field tacklers there to be able to make this play. You see Hayden Carlson's on the unit, and Alessi right there where he needed to be.
Harford offense moved the ball right down the field inside the 10, then eventually kicked a field goal on its first drive, Ross. They've been stalled ever since. What would you like to see them do?
I think that they need to do two things. One is get back to Shelton Mosley on the underneath crossing pattern stuff, and I also think Jake Smith, the freshman quarterback, is going to have to use his legs more than he has so far.
Shelton Mosley, 3 catches for 43 yards, all on that first drive. Smith dropped in the backfield, another sack. Opplinger leads the Ivy League in tackles for loss and produces that big play there.
Also leads the Ivy League in sacks. Second in all of FCS, coming in with 9.5 sacks. Let's give him all of that one. Hayden Carlson was in there as well, but Opplinger coming off the edge against a linebacker, I mean against a tight end, I should say. That is a mismatch.
That would have been a chance for Smith to use his legs if he could have gotten outside. Takes the sack, and it'll bring up second down 17.
Now you're probably looking at either a run or more underneath screen draw type of plays.
And an option. There's Smith using that speed, and the late pitch, ill-advised pitch, scoop and score. Malcolm Dixon puts 6 on the board. Freshman mistakes, Ross, come in all different kind of forms.
You said it, man. Just about to say, that is a freshman mistake that you just can't make. Maybe that was something that he did in high school. Certainly it looked like he had some room and was excited. Got on the edge, was picking up a big gain, and thought he could make an even bigger one.
Alex Gallant's second extra points. This one makes it 14-3. Well, Smith had something going, a little acceleration. It was just the wrong time to try that pitch.
The problem with it too, Paul, to your point, is that you lose the relationship between the quarterback and the running back when you get that far downfield like that. It's not the same. They're used to making this pitch over and over again, right there. But once you get down the field like this, it's not the same distance. And it was clearly thrown behind Champlin, and that is one that Jake Smith will learn from. Only a freshman, he'll play a lot of football for Harvard, and my guess is he'll never do that again.
You bring up a great point in that you lose that relationship as soon as you get past the line of scrimmage. Another layer to that, he's a right-hander trying to make that difficult pitch with his left hand. It all adds up to Malcolm Dixon with the scoop and the score, and Tony Reno feeling a lot better these last 10 minutes. J.P. Schofie with a big catch, then a touchdown reception. They come out on the next drive.
How about it feels like the last 10 seconds? I mean, 2 touchdowns in last 5 or 6 plays. Crazy how quickly things can turn.
10 minutes of real time.
Yeah, you're right.
Short period of time football-wise. The squib kick. And Harvard will begin on the 25-yard line. Spend your Black Friday feasting on hockey. Penguins take on the Bruins in the Discover NHL Thanksgiving Showdown. Friday, 1 o'clock Eastern on NBC. That comes after a little bit of football, or a whole lot of football, on Thursday.
Yep, I'll be in Detroit taking in the Vikings and the Lions, of course, big Thursday night game as well.
Giants-Redskins coming up. See how Jake Smith can respond to his mistake and how the offense as a whole can respond to trailing now 14-3. Evades the pressure. Gets what he can just across the 30-yard line.
You have to give him credit for keeping his eyes downfield and wanting to throw the football, but there's a lot of room there. You know, you'd like to see him just tuck it away and just go. The backup quarterback is a fifth-year senior, Joe Viviana, who's played a lot. You know, kind of go for broke in this game. Get every yard you can.
We talked to Tim Murphy before the Princeton game in October, and he said about the offense, we're a work in progress. Talked to him this week. He said, we remain a work in progress. Freshman quarterback having a lot to do with that. Jake Smith steps up. Good job there. Completion out to the 40-yard line. That'll be first down, Harvard. And the tight end, Dan Werner, with that reception.
Well, we're going on almost six quarters without Harvard scoring a touchdown. Just so rare.
An offense that's been so consistent, Ross, I think led by the offensive line and then just a string of talented, productive quarterbacks. And one thing I discovered from talking to you and listening to Ivy League coaches around the league this year is that the offensive line at Harvard, while respectable, just isn't quite up to the same standards. Second play in a row on the option. It's a fumble, and Yale happy to be right there and scoop it up.
Wow.
Hunter Roman with that recovery.
Watch 23, Foye Aluaka. You know, he's got the quarterback there. And nobody really has Champlin.
Another pitch to the left.
That was the first one. That was a near interception earlier. And then this is the one we just saw that led to the touchdown for Dixon. Boy.
And that those all preceded the turnover we just saw. Now the option to the left's not working for the Harvard offense. We'll see what the Yale offense can do from its own 38. Williams-Lopez, his first reception.
And he's been behind with every pitch too, Paul. You know, he's been consistently behind. He's not leading Champlin. It's been behind Champlin.
And that's reception for Williams-Lopez, actually for a loss of a couple.
Wow, look at those yardage numbers at the bottom.
J.P. Schofi, 45-yard reception on the last drive. For the big play, and there's Rawlings to his tight end, Jaden Graham. Down to the 46-yard line.
Kind of surprising to see Yale come out throwing like this on this drive. You know, you're up 14-3. You get the best rushing attack in the league by far.
That is struggling, though. Seven carries for only 13 yards for Dudek to this point.
Goes without saying, Paul, but Harvard really needs to stop here. This could be four down territory for Yale, though, where they are on the field.
And there's Dudek up the middle, and that's the Yale first down to the 25-yard line.
Best blocked run of the day so far. It's not even close. It's a power scheme to the right. They pull around Marbach, the left tackle. He gets a great block on Hutton. Excellent double team at the point of attack there. Look at that. That is a thing of beauty there. Now maybe the best offensive line in the Ivy League starting to kick in a little bit.
See if that'll get Dudek going a little bit. Play action. Williams-Lopez had a step on Tim Heil. The pass was just a little bit too far out front.
Really like that play call there because it was the exact same run. They faked the run, exact same play. It looked the same. Look at the linebackers. I mean, it looks the same to them. And had what he wanted man-to-man. Just a good play there by Hale.
5'10", 180 junior out of Spanish Fort, Alabama. 3 wide receivers to the left of Rawlings. fires it out that way to draw. And the linebacker, Charlie Walker, there.
And that's a heck of a play, too, by Hale. Hale stood up the receiver in front of draw, took on that block. It's another third and long for Yale. Harvard's done an excellent job on first and second down in this game. Could they run it again like they did on the previous third down?
And got 10 from Dudak. Rawlings right now 10 out of 16 for 91 yards. There's one touchdown and one pick. Good call, Ross. It's Dudek again, but this time the Harvard defense was there.
Look at the mud on the jersey. That is beautiful. That's what it's supposed to look like. Good game so far by Alex White. Getting more playing time with some of the injuries to some of the other Harvard linebackers this year.
And here's Yale again. They line up this way, and extra points in the field goal to begin. See what they get with the alignments if they want to run a fake. A whistle blew just before.
Harvard called timeout.
Second timeout of the half. Harvard, 30 seconds.
And that's Andrew Johnson, backup quarterback, out there directing the way. Getting close to halftime here, coming up on the Geico Halftime Report. Scores and highlights from around college football. Big games going on early today. We'll check in or let you check in on all that action. And Johnny Lujack, a feature on the Heisman Trophy winner from Notre Dame. Get you caught up in all that's going on around the country outside of the Yale Bowl here. 134th meeting of the game. And Yale in control 14-3. A win for the Bulldogs would mean the outright conference title. Columbia and Dartmouth could share that title if Harvard comes back and wins, and this is what's going on here. That is if Dartmouth wins and also if Columbia wins.
Brown has the early lead on, or sorry, Columbia has the early lead on Brown as expected. Princeton up on Dartmouth early up in Hanover.
Fourth down and eight, the number one fourth down team in the Ivy League. The Bulldogs 8 out of 10 converted. This will be a tough one on fourth and eight. Harvard brings four. Plenty of time for Rawlings and finds Troll at the 8-yard line. That's how you convert fourth and eight. A lot of time and some accuracy.
Well, they just came with a three-man rush, so Rawlings had as much time as he wanted to unload that football there. And how about the timeout from Harvard? That led Yale to reconsider the field goal attempt, and they elected to go for it instead. Wow, that is a brutal timeout for Harvard.
First down and goal now. All of Yale's 14 points coming in this end zone here in the second quarter. Dudak looking for more, dives into the end zone. There is a touch, is a penalty marker, two penalty markers out at the 10-yard line.
Pretty blatant hold there. This one's coming back.
Holy. Offense. Number 79. 10 yards in the previous spot. Still first down.
I think it's funny that Marbach's saying, what are you talking about? I'll tell you exactly what you're talking about, Carl. Take a look at him blocking the defensive end. Watch his left hand. It's outside the framework of the body. Watch. Pulls it in. Now they're going to call it every time, man. Every time. If you are restricting the movement of the defender, you can have your hands inside, you can grab the defender's cloth, but if you're restricting movement outside the framework of your body like that, they're going to call that 10 out of 10 times.
Aren't you federally mandated as an offensive lineman to throw your hands up? Like, what do I do?
If you're out there, yeah, if you're out there.
And Yale's going to continue to move backward now, the early movement.
False start, 84, yeah. Offense, 84. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Called against Christopher Williams-Lopez, top receiver for Yale, just one catch so far today.
Well, Harvard's definitely winning in the penalty battle so far. Look at those numbers. We might end up getting the exact same field goal attempt that we were going to get about 2 minutes ago.
When all is said and done, 108 left here until halftime. Harvard led 3-0 after one. Yale with a couple of touchdowns, one from the offense, one from the defense in the second quarter. Rawlings across the middle, completion down to the 6-yard line. That's Williams Lopez. Now inside of 1 minute, gain of 17.
We've talked about the difference from the Harvard team offensively from last year, Paul. The difference defensively is this. Look how much time Rawling has. I mean, he's got as much time as he wants. A good job by Iselin, the left guard, against Stonehart's bull rush there.
Brings up second down goal. Bad snap, and Dudek goes down to the backfield. Alex White pushes him back. That'll bring up third and goal.
Yale's going to call a timeout now this time.
You can see the frustration there for Dudek. Kind of sums up his whole first half.
Well, it was a read play, but because the snap was off center there, there really was no time for Rawlings to even read it.
We've seen a lot of plays like that in the run game for the Harvard defense. They've done a nice job the first half. You had the big play from Rawlings to J.P. Shofi, a 45-yarder. That led to the touchdown pass from inside the 10-yard line, that same connection. And moments later, the defense put points on the board for Yale. Malcolm Dixon picked up the errant option pitch from Jake Smith. And that's how you get to 14-3, but the majority of this half, the Harvard defense has been there.
They really have. We'll see if they come right back to that play to J.P. Shofi or Siragusa, matched up against the smaller corners. Do they go to the fade route again?
Well, he has Shofi all the way out to the right. In the slot to the right is 84 Williams Lopez. And they give it to Dudek, picking his way inside the 10, but doesn't get past the 7. Interesting call on third and goal.
I think maybe they thought they could fool Harvard and pop one. Instead, now they'll let the clock go all the way down, call a timeout, and kick a field goal to go up 2 touchdowns.
Well, that's 10 carries and 20 yards for Dudek, the top rusher in this conference. The front 7 for the Crimson up to the challenge.
30 seconds.
Updated look at Dudek. It's now 11 carries for 24 yards. See there what we have coming up on the Geico Halftime Report.
Bunch of good games going on right now. Virginia against Miami, Michigan, Wisconsin. Plus, isn't Johnny Lujack just an awesome name,
right?
Like, I wish my name was Johnny Lujack. I go up to everybody I met, Johnny Lujack, Heisman winner. Johnny Lujack here. Johnny Lujack. Just sounds like a Heisman winner. Sounds awesome.
Learn a lot about Ross hanging out with him here. Likes the name Johnny Lujack. Last Yale game here, you liked the long blonde hair of Kurt Rawlings. And
yes.
Wish you could have pulled that off when you were playing.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
I like things that are awesome. Can you blame me?
Not one bit. Alex Galland from 25 yards out. Makes it look easy. And Yale finishes the first half with an exclamation point. Wasn't that long ago they were trailing 3-0, but J.P. Shofi touchdown, Malcolm Dixon touchdown, and that field goal. And it's now 17-3.
It really was the big play to Shofi and then those 2 turnovers that enabled Yale to get a double score lead here.
Let's check in on the sideline with Carolyn Manna.
Well, Coach, you head into halftime with the momentum, but some penalties early and Harvard's defense really standing their ground. How would you assess the first half for you?
Well, we haven't really played well in the first half, especially with the mental pieces of holding our poise on some of the formational shifts we've had and the motion penalties. We've got to clean that up. I mean, you can't do that against a great Harvard team.
Defensively, does anything need to change for you, or are you satisfied?
Well, we got to stand in there. The quarterbacks are moving the ball real well. They've scrambled really well. They've taken some shots, and you know they've been close on a couple of those deep balls, so we've got to do a better job there.
Coach, thank you.
Thank you.
Carolyn, Tony, thank you very much. Head to halftime here at the Yale Bowl, the 134th playing of the game. Started out all Harvard, but J.P. Shofi got it started, and the fans like what they saw. They like this even more. He scores their first touchdown. Malcolm Dixon adds one right here. we head to the halftime break with the Bulldogs on top by 14.
Our coverage of the game from 2017 continues, and we're joined by another special guest, class of 2020 defensive back, and the guy who made the big play in the second quarter, Malcolm Dixon. Malcolm, my first question is this. Why Yale?
I ended up choosing Yale for a couple of different reasons. I think I could summarize it into three. So one of them, I have a lot of family in Connecticut. My mom's from Connecticut. So that was a huge factor. That was one of the one driving force. Two, mechanical engineering that was available at the school. But three, and most importantly, I think everybody on the team, future and past, can really attest to this, was kind of just like the brotherhood mentality, kind of like just the feel and the vibe amongst the team and amongst the coaches. On my official visit, I felt it, especially when I got here. Once I got here, it really, you know, took a life of its own. And I can confidently say that my 4 years on that team have been some of the best years of my life.
From observation, and definitely not experience, mechanical engineering is one of the most intensive majors at Yale. It really challenges the balance between student and athlete and shows an incredible dedication to the academic side of being in college.
Definitely. Mechanical engineering is tough. It's not just tough at Yale. It's tough at every school in the country. And, you know, whether you play football or not, it's still tough. And that requires, you know, some form of dedication and, you know, work ethic and discipline. And, you know, counterintuitively, you know, people, you think, you know, playing football, that would make it harder for me to have these abilities. But I definitely think football definitely helped shape that mindset that, you know, it was hard, but it's not something that I can't do. It's not something that other people can't do or other people haven't done already.
Now, looking back at this game in 2017, the team had a slip up at Dartmouth, but the Bulldogs were rolling coming into this game against Harvard.
2017 season was definitely one of the best seasons of football I've ever been a part of in my entire life. I think this season, so like this past season, this 2019 season where we also won. I think the difference between 2019 and 2017 season was the 2017, it definitely felt like we were in a groove. In 2019, it felt like we were in a groove, but it felt more like we were really, really fighting for what we ended up accomplishing. Because after that Dartmouth loss this year, it was looking bleak. But after we lost to Dartmouth 2017, it was like an immediate, all right, let's get right back to it. And I think that mindset carried over to this 2019 season. But yeah, 2017 was a very special year. That Dartmouth slip up definitely hurts, still does every time. But I think that loss is what, you know, got us on that roll. You know, Coach Reno talks about adversity, response to adversity being very important. And I think our response to just the season and how we carried ourselves and how we approached, you know, the games following that game and just practice and everything we did together on the field and off the field, I think really, I think that was special. I think that was definitely the biggest reason 2017 was so fruitful, for lack of a better term. You know, because Dartmouth wasn't our only tough game. Princeton, that was – that was an incredible comeback on both sides of the ball. We had some tough games, but I think this team's ability to respond to adversity is second to none.
The big play in the game defensively was your fumble recovery for a touchdown in the second quarter. So let's set the scene. Harvard put together a drive to start the game and got a field goal. But moving into the second quarter, the game was a back and forth field position battle. Take us through this fumble recovery, because looking back at it, it took a lot of the wind out of the Crimson sails even before halftime.
So the Harvard game, I ended up playing like nickel. Yeah, I was like playing like nickel. I really wasn't playing corner in that game. So that was pretty fun. That was a really fun game. I remember guarding one of their tight ends, just essentially him probably not getting the ball. It was very muddy that day. I was like, I'm not really working that hard to cover him. But I was like, he's probably not getting it. I see the quarterback pop out. I see the running back pop out. So, you know, their option play. So, you know, Coach McGowan, obviously we don't watch the Harvard film, but I was very under the impression that if I was not sprinting to this ball, because it looked like it was about to break. So I was like, let me get out there right now. I was like, I gotta at least turn it in or get a pitch. Man, I actually don't even remember what my responsibility was. I haven't played nickel in a minute. But I just remember going out, you know, running out there. I think someone hit the quarterback. I think that was, yeah, I don't know who hit him, but he pitched it. Like I said, very muddy conditions, nobody there for the ball. And I just remember seeing the ball. I looked up and I was like, oh, this could be good. I picked it up. I genuinely don't have the greatest fumble recovery skills, but, you know, we practice it every once in a while. Actually, we practice it a pretty decent amount, which is probably why I picked it up. got it, picked it up, like, and then I think I said this in that, you know, press conference. I saw the ball, I saw the end zone, and you catch me if you can, I guess. I don't know.
That was Malcolm Dixon, Yale defensive back in the class of 2020. He made a big defensive play in the 2017 edition of The Game, which continues now.
Rawlings, he wanted to go for it on fourth and a yard, but the punt team comes out.
Rawlings and Dudek both immediately looked at the sideline and said, let's go for it. You got to love youthful enthusiasm, right? Youthful ambition. You're up by 14 points at your own 33-yard line. Not going for that.
I actually thought they were going to go.
What are you guys talking about?
That's what happens when you're 9 for 11 on fourth down this season, including 1 for 1 today. Jelt Mosey lets it drop. And that'll roll to the 28-yard line. It was moving in this direction in the first quarter when the Harvard offense had its one impressive drive. We'll see if they can put another one together when we come back to the game. The Jake Smith-led Harvard offense coming back on the field, looking to get anything going. You see that right there. Seven quarters now without a touchdown, and look at that, only 2 rushing yards. They are without Charlie Booker, the second leading rusher in the Ivy League with an upper body injury. He's sitting this one out, but less than 100 yards here in the third quarter of total offense. Smith passing on first down, wants Justice Shelton Mosley. And that one broken up. Nice job of defense by Rimashevsky.
Rimashevsky is so good. He is really talented. Was first team all Ivy in 2015. Missed last year. Just man-to-man coverage. Look at that right hand up there. He almost Odell Beckham Jr. that right there and almost brought it in. Excellent coverage. Coach Murphy, you can see in the background there, wanted a penalty, but didn't get it.
led the Ivy League in tackles in 2015, in spite of the fact that he needed shoulder surgery on both shoulders after the season. Champlin out to the 35-yard line. And here we are once again with Harford facing a third down, and so far Ross, they're just 1 for 7 converted.
This is at least third and relatively short. And we've said it a couple times, Paul, let's say it again. Jake Smith can run. He's got pretty good wheels that we'd like to see him take advantage of a little bit here in the second half.
Yale's been pretty aggressive. They bring one extra blitzer there. Keeps it himself. Aluakon there to meet him in the backfield. Another third down stop.
They've seen that play one too many times. I was thinking more a drop back pass and then scramble for the first down. They do the read play there. Puts it in the belly. Aluakon was having nothing of it.
Having a big afternoon in the backfield of Harvard, also running perimeter to perimeter. Another three and out. Alessi with the fair catch at his own 19-yard line. With all the deals, drama, and dough, there really is no place like it on earth. Shark Tank, weeknight, starting 7 o'clock Eastern on CNBC. Get yours. Paul Burmeister, Ross Tucker, and Carolyn Mano on the sideline. Yale in control. Harvard led 3-0 after one. J.P. Shofi had a touchdown reception. Malcolm Dixon picked up an errant option pitch, ran it in for a score, and a late field goal. That's how Yale leads 17-3. Dudek cutting it back, shuffling. That body lean we've seen from him his entire freshman year, always leaning forward. And a positive gain there.
You know, at 6'5", 300, which is the average for Yale, they just start to lean on you and wear you down. I think that's one of the things that happened there. Dudek breaks a couple tackles too, but this Yale offensive line averages 6'5", 300, and Harvard has a number of defensive linemen out, so they can't rotate as much as they usually like to.
Dudek down at the 25-yard line.
And now Dudek has to come out of the game.
The helmet comes off, you got to come out.
Your helmet comes off, you got to come out of the game. Dudek saying, how do you think that happened? How do you think my helmet came off? Pretty good job there. Inside first by Scott Garrison.
So I mentioned a moment ago is Dudek on the sideline now. Mandatory to set out that one play. Harvard just 1 for 8 on third down. Well, Yale not a whole lot better than 3 out of 11. Now it's going to be 3 out of 12. Williams Lopez with the catch.
They got it. Good job on the blitz pickup there by the backup running back. You'll see Rouse, number 7, right side of your screen. Really, you want to get your hands inside there. They could call you for a hold, but still a nice job.
Did end up picking up the first down. This Rouse spinning his way, fighting to get back to that line of scrimmage. Eventually, Charlie Walker finished him off.
That's a lot of effort to get smacked in the face, you know? I mean, that's a heck of a lot of effort just to take one of the chops. Watch number 50, Richie Ryan. He splits the double team from Pittsburgh Central Catholic, spins Rouse around, Rouse, boom! Just gets popped right there at the end.
Richie Ryan earned high praise from the Harvard coaches when we talked to him this week.
They said he has played very well. 50, Richie Ryan, 90, Stonehart.
Fumbled snap, Rawlings picks it up. Non-conventional completion there to his third side end, Connor Fury.
That's when you know it's your day. You know, I mean, when Harvard messes up the pitch, they lose the ball. Watch this. It hits Stuther in the rear end. I've been there, Paul. He tried to snap the shotgun snap. I think it hit him right in the rear end. How about Rawlings? Watch this. Let's see if it hit. Oh, no, he never got it up. Mm-mm. He never got it up. Sometimes, especially with the way that field is down there and there's divots and stuff, the tip of the ball, as you go to shotgun the ball back, gets caught on the ground itself. Heads-up play by Rawlings.
This time, inside give to Dudek. to the 40-yard line.
Gonna be close.
On third down and two, looks like he's just a little short.
The Yale players want to go again. And my guess is Tony Reno will punt it again, although he hasn't sent the punt team out there just yet.
Offense staying out there, fourth and less than a yard.
Let me say for the record, do not agree with this. There's no reason to give Harvard any chance to get momentum by stopping you here. Maybe a little pooch punt here.
There you go, that extra step back. Good call, Ross.
I do agree with that. Nobody back for Harvard.
Right?
Perfect.
Well done by Rawlings as well, and especially when you consider how well the Yale defense is playing. Harvard offense hasn't moved since its first possession. Yale continues to lead by 14.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Great look at the Yale Bowl, now 103 years old. They were expecting 60,000, looks like they got that.
A lot of people here, that's for sure.
Scores to keep an eye on: Columbia and Dartmouth, especially if they win, and if Yale loses, they would share the Ivy League Conference crown. You see what they're doing there, tight games here on this Saturday. Currently Yale on top 17-3. Jake Smith to Justice Shelton Mosley, his fifth catch of the game, and that's a first down. That's the connection that drove their first and only scoring drive.
So I've never been an offensive coordinator. I know you are, Paul, for your son's flag football team. How about just calling this play every time? Okay, let's call the shallow crossing pattern to Justice Shelton Mosley. Been by far the most successful play for Harvard today.
Champlin off the right side, trying to reach that edge, gets it, and that's another Harvard first down. On a bit of a roll are the Crimson here in the third quarter.
You know, just getting back to that crossing pattern, Shelton Mosley, we'll talk about it after we see Champlin, who's got the speed to get the edge. Very impressive. But on those crossing routes against man-to-man coverage, you know, they had crossers going both ways, almost acts as a rub route or a pick route. And that's one of the reasons why Shelton Mosley was so wide open.
And by the way, our best passing play? That's Shelton Mosley. Works out every single level. First and 10. And Smith not going to get away from that trouble. Down at the 40-yard line, Hayden Carlson from his safety spot.
And that's one of the things that Jake Smith will learn, is you got to throw this ball away. I mean, you can't take this sack right here. Right here, you got to throw it to somebody, because it just makes it so difficult to have any chance to have success on this series when you're second and 17 now. I mean, it just,
you
look
at
the, yeah, that's what I'm saying, throw the ball away. You look at the stats, Paul, when you have a holding penalty or a sack, it's very, very difficult to get first downs after that, especially a sack.
Second 17, see if they can get a little bit back, but he just threw that one away. And third and 17 is an even worse side for an offensive coordinator than second and 17. He's trying to get the ball back to Justice Shelton Mosley. Well, Jake Smith was not intended to be the starting quarterback of this team. That job was going to be for Joe Viviano, but they lost that first game against Rhode Island. They lost the last two games of last year, including the one to Yale. And the coaches were open to thinking about a change, and his athleticism made him think hard about it. And here he is now, third and 17.
Oh,
there's the shallow cross, this time to the running back, Champlin. It's like he wasn't expecting it.
The defender fell down. They had it. He was going to get the first down on third and 17. Right there. Oh, the ball went right to, there was nobody there. He was going to run for that first down.
Didn't get his head around in time.
No.
So a couple of quick first downs on that drive that started out in an encouraging way, and it ends the way most of them have for the Crimson here this afternoon, with third down and long being an incompletion. Alessi, another fair catch on the punts.
He lost
fumble.
And he muffed that one.
Wow. Got it back again.
Number 19 got on it at the 19-yard line. Scary moment there.
That was Harvard's opportunity right there. Somebody's got to be right around him right there.
Almost big play for the Harvard special teams. Inside of 5 minutes left in the third, Yale on top.
Welcome back to the Yale Bowl, everybody. This was built back in 1914, and it's remained largely unchanged, which is why it's so beautiful, the simplicity of it. But I want to show you the Yale Tunnel, because there's something new for this game making its debut. You can see inside here, it's been painted, and there's new pictures and inspirational quotes that have been put up. You see Head Coach Tony Reno and some of the more recent Yale players. But as you get further and further into this tunnel, and the locker rooms are at the very end, you start to see some of Yale's really rich history. Carm Cosa, legendary Yale coach who brought them 10 Ivy League titles, is back here. And all the way at the very end is the father of American football himself, Walter Camp, who went to Yale and invented things like the line of scrimmage, the system of downs, everything that you consider the game today to be while you're watching at home. He went to Yale in the 70s, Paul and Ross, and by the 70s, I mean the 1870s, but still a very, very special new look tunnel here at Yale.
Carolyn, thank you very much. Well done. I was at practice at Wednesday, Ross, and the coaches made the players take that tunnel down in here just so they could see the work that had been done. It was all set up and ready for the game here.
They call those impact walls because they have a big impact on recruits when they come on visits.
Whoa. Rawlings takes his first sack of the day. Charlie Walker. Huge hit.
Charlie Walker has been everywhere. I mean, all these Harvard linebackers have been, but especially every time Rawlings gets in the open field, number 41 comes flying out of nowhere. That is a big time play by Walker. Look at the acceleration. You don't run to the tackle, you run through it.
Boom.
Bam. You and I both did that at the same time. You went boom, I went bam. Yeah. And they were both right.
It wasn't even planned. Loss of 4 yards, second and 14. And he had Jaden Graham. Tight end, and throws it well behind him to bring up third down and 14. As we look at the Yale Bowl, the foliage in behind it settled down in here. You see some of the facts about this building that, as Carolyn mentioned, opened up a little over 100 years ago. How about the Giants played here for a couple of years? Yankee Stadium was being worked on. The
Unbelievable.
Meadowlands not done yet.
The Grateful Dead, the Eagles. I can totally picture the Grateful Dead here.
You deadhead?
No. No, but I can picture 60,000 deadheads being here.
Third and 14, they only rush three. And Rawlings, that's a nice pass to Ross Draw.
Wow.
Couldn't hang on to it.
That would have been a big first down for Yale. Keep the clock moving. Draw's got some guns on him. It's a well put together wide receiver right there.
How about the hands on that play, though? There we go. Handsome Dan. This version's name is Walter.
Why is it not Dan?
Well, it's, you know, he's all the handsome Dans have their own.
Got it, okay.
Their own little name. On campus almost every day. Done a good job of keeping it away from Justice Shelton Mosley.
They really have.
Top punt returner in the nation. Now, Yale believes that ball touched a Harvard player.
It's been a big factor in the game. I mean, Shelton Mosley, number one in all of FCS football, almost 19 yards per return. He's got two touchdowns this year. They just haven't been able to get him in space as much as they're trying, as they want to, or get him the ball to get on the return.
And we've seen this sequence a number of times so far today, Ross, where The Harvard defense comes through. The offense takes over with decent field position. This is actually very good field position inside of Yale territory. And they just can't sustain a drive, with the exception of the one scoring drive, which was their first of the afternoon. First and 10 from the Bulldog 49. Jake Smith, the freshman, continues to go at quarterback. And we've seen that a number of times as well. Another sack. John Harubin is there.
Earl Chisholm got in there as well, 48 and 47. A couple of senior defensive linemen. And here's another one where it looked like Smith, right there, he's got to throw the ball. I think sometimes your athleticism can be a curse because you feel like you can get out of certain situations that you just can't. He couldn't find anybody open, but you're much, much better off throwing the ball away there.
Sixth sack of the afternoon by Yale. It's Northington up the middle. And this is the definition of what Harvard's been dealing with. Third down and more than 10.
Just makes it so hard. I mean, third and 15 plus, there might be two or three plays that the offensive coordinator, Joel Lamb, has on his sheet. They almost might want to think of something, Paul, where they complete something short of the line to gain and then go for it on fourth down at this point. I mean, you're down 14 points and you have less than 18 minutes remaining in your season. Get half of it here and then maybe go on four.
They're 1 for 9 converting on third down so far. This is third and 16. Has the completion, but little else. Foye Aluaka there to bring down Shelton Mosley.
It's been that kind of day for Harvard and, frankly, that kind of season. You know, they're still a 5-4 team with 5 wins, but they just have not been able to get it going offensively like they have in previous years.
And Ross, that was the exact same play they hit on twice on that first drive.
Yep.
And Aluaka has seen that before and knew exactly what to do. Alessi hangs on that time in the exact same spot, the 19-yard line, where he had the muff earlier this quarter. Sunday night is football night. Big one coming up. Carson Wentz and the league-leading Eagles, the NFC East-leading Eagles, take on Dak Prescott and the Cowboys. Coverage begins at 7 o'clock Eastern. Thanksgiving night, another NFC East showdown, the Giants and the Redskins in prime time on NBC. Cowboys, Eagles, what do you like?
Oh, Eagles. I mean, Cowboys, no Tyron Smith, no Zeke Elliott, no Sean Lee.
Sean Lee.
That's 3 of their 5 most important players. I mean, that makes it really tough. It really does.
And Rawlings finds J.P. Shofi. He had 4 receptions in the first half, including 1 for a touchdown. That's good enough for a Yale first.
First down, always the best down to throw the football. The defense is really geared up to stop the run. Little bootleg play action off of it. It's really well done all the way around. Shofi runs off Rayshon McGee, the corner, who slips a little bit trying to come out of his break.
Now back to the ground. Dudek up the middle. Penalty marker comes down just across that 30-yard line. Dudek still struggling to get going. Only 15 carries for 33 yards.
Oh, offsides on the defense that time. That hurts.
Defense that's done a really nice job against Dudek so far today. The last 3 games, his production just sky high, averaging 21 carries for 172 yards. Right now, stuck on 33 total. He steps out, Melvin Rouse in at tailback now. And Rawlings will slide just as he got to that first down marker. I think he got just enough to pick up the first.
What is it about coaches' kids? They just know. You know what I mean? He just knows. He knew right where he needed to go. Accelerates. He doesn't do this a lot, but it's
just
something
enough.
He can do. Just enough is exactly right. I mean, he wasn't really happy taking a shot there after he slid either, by the way.
His father, Keith, was his high school coach in Bel Air, Maryland. Grew up watching tape, hanging out in the practice field. Dudek back in, now back up the middle, fighting for a little extra across the 45. Says a lot about what Harvard has done that we can say that's one of his best carries so far today.
It really does. And I think Rawlings will be smart enough here to take it to the quarter with a 17-3 lead. No reason to run another play here if you're Yale. He's a coach's kid. He knows the deal. I think, what they say, some people call him Sunshine because of the haircut. How about Fresh Prince? He's from Bel Air, Maryland. We go Fresh Prince?
He's got a little late 70s Nick Nolte thing going
on. He probably doesn't even know what the Fresh Prince is. Like 19 years old. Or Nick Nolte.
He has no idea Nick Nolte is. Three quarters of the game in the books. Yale one quarter away from an outright Ivy League championship. Welcome back to the Yale Bowl here at the game. Fourth quarter about to begin. There's Tony Reno, center of the screen. And you see where he's been and what he's done. Actually spent time at Harvard as an assistant coach. Was here at Yale before that, then Yale afterward. And there he is representing the Crimson 2009 to 2011. Now in his seventh season at Yale and a quarter away from claiming the conference championship. For more on Tony Reno and what he's doing here at Yale, let's go to the sideline and check in with Carolyn.
Paul, hey, well, this being the Ivy League, Tony has had to set the bar really high when finding ways to motivate his players. And one of the things that he said over and over again is E plus R squared equals O. The event plus the response squared equals the outcome. And I am not an Ivy Leaguer, Ross. I will admit that. So I had to ask Coach Reno, what does the O stand for? Does it stand for offense? He said, no, Carolyn, it stands for outcome. But don't feel too bad. I went to Worcester State. Either way, I think we're both doing something right.
Carolyn, thank you. And I join you there in the public school background. Rawlings flushed out to his left on third down, late penalty marker. Just as he got outside the pocket, leaping to a first down.
They're going to get Marbach again, the left tackle.
And again, he's probably going to think he didn't do it.
Second holding penalty against the Rocket Scientist.
Holding. Offense. Number 79. 10 yards from the previous spot. Still third down.
Literally a rocket scientist, by the way. I'll get into that. You see him at the top of your screen. Watch right here. Right there as Rawlings goes in. He's got that grab almost identical to the other holding penalty he had. But Marbach is part of the Yale Undergraduate Aerospace Association. He built and launched a rocket last offseason.
Not like helped build. He actually built
it. No, he built it. He is a rocket scientist.
It's just fun to say.
Yeah.
Third down and 12. Little touch pass, and that's a great job of playmaking by Kurt Rawlings. Finds Siragusa Jr. inside the 40-yard line. First down, Bulldogs.
This is what makes Rawlings so special. This is what we saw last year starting in that Columbia game and in last year's Harvard game. On the move, still looking downfield, Siragusa uncovers. And that is a huge, huge first down. Good job by the rocket scientist Marbach. And they get the first down. By the way, if I was a rocket scientist, I'd probably wear a t-shirt that said, I am a rocket scientist. Like, seriously.
Would you change your name to Johnny Lujack and have the long blonde hair?
Uh-oh.
Melvin Rouse finding some room off the left side. Still on his feet inside the 15. Normally a slot back, looking pretty good at tailback on that one.
How about having multiple stud freshman running backs? One of the best blocked plays of the day. Rouse only goes about 170 pounds, but he can really scoot.
A freshman out of East Charlotte, North Carolina, quite an athlete in high school. Set a school record, the triple jump, played lacrosse. Good chunk of athletic ability there as well. First down and 10. There's Rouse again inside the five and almost had enough to take it in. Have to settle with a gain down to the three.
Kind of feels like the dam is about to break, doesn't it, Paul? I mean, Harbor's done such a good job all game. Little inside counter play. They pulled both the right guard and the right tackle. Huge seam there. Rouse goes right up the middle and feels like they're awfully close to getting the Ivy League outright title clinching score here.
And freshmen everywhere you look in the backfield for Kurt Rawlings, who's only a sophomore. Future's bright here, including the immediate future here, first and goal. Rawlings to the end zone to Saragusa. Penalty marker comes in.
Man, I don't know about that. First glance, it looked like both guys were doing a little hand fighting there. Saragusa is a big kid.
Pass interference. Defense, number 36. Foul occurred in the end zone. By rule, the ball will be placed on the 2-yard line. First down.
Call goes against Tanner Lee. That's a pretty good play.
That's a perfect play. It looked to me like they threw the flag for what happened earlier, but you heard my philosophy earlier, Paul. When in doubt, don't throw the flag. That's one I would have kept in my pocket.
Saw the raindrops in the camera on that shot. It just started to come down again. It started earlier in the second half and went away. Now the sprinkles are back. First and goal once again. Touchdown, Bulldogs. Dudek with his 16th touchdown of the season, easily the highest number in the Ivy League.
School record 16th touchdown for freshmen. And this is just inside zone. They're just coming right at you, and it's well blocked across the way. Harvard's defense has spent too much time on the field, and they've finally gotten worn down. What a turn of events.
Man.
9 years in a row, Harvard won this game, and Yale is now poised to win their second in a row.
And don't forget, Harvard had won, or they have won, seven consecutive games here at the Yale Bowl. An eighth looks like a long shot now, down 23-3. And now make it 24-3. Melvin Rouse with some impressive running down the field. And he gives way to the top tailback, Zane Dudek. Right up the middle, his first touchdown of the day. 16th of the season. Yale students can sense what's coming, an outright conference title.
We hope you're enjoying our re-air of the game from 2017. And our final special guest of the day is Micah Awodiran, now senior linebacker, then a rookie making big plays for the Bulldogs. Micah, how are you?
I'm doing well, you know, with COVID and everything, we've really just tried to pivot as best as we can. You know that Coach Reno and the guys, we really try to uphold the standards, you know, no different if we were in the weight room in New Haven. So, you know, staying in good contact with the guys, you know, just trying to lead the path forward to hopefully another successful fall campaign in 2021.
Micah, everyone has a different story as to how they came to New Haven. So for you, why Yale?
It was pretty unique, my path. So early on in recruiting, was getting a lot of looks from schools, you know, across the country, different levels and things like that. And, you know, it's very easy to get into the glitz and glamour. But when I stepped on campus at Yale for the first time, you know, being shown around by another alum, Marquise Peggs, a Chicago guy as well. I could really just feel the difference in the air, you know, the attention to detail, the, you know, investment in one another. Those were some things that were so paramount for me and that I felt right from the time that I was there. And they really just set Yale apart. You know, besides just the team atmosphere, Yale University speaks for itself academically and, you know, socially as a place where you can come and engage in some of the things that, you know, just take you outside of your perspective and, you know, help you to grow both in your 4 years and the many years that come after. So the 4 for 40 was apparent, you know, both 5 years ago, right now to this day, and I'm sure it will be further down the road.
This 2017 football season was an incredible one. It was your first season on campus, and it was a road loss early in the year. But the week before this game, you all completed one of the great comebacks in Yale history, which was also on the road down at Princeton.
Man, oh my gosh, that Princeton game. You know, what I remember from that, and I believe it was Anders Huizenga, you know, his motto for that game was earn your stripes. And, you know, we were playing the Tigers, so, you know, he was like, for the guys that are going to take the field, do everything that it takes to win that game. Earn your stripes. You know, the job wasn't finished. And through the beginning, all the way through the end, when we were singing that fight song over in New Jersey, everyone was really just trying to earn their stripes. I remember game to game, my roles were changing. And that time, you know, the only time I was taking the field was special teams. And, you know, I was trying to go and block a punt, and you know, I ran through an offensive lineman, a personal protector, and running back to the sideline, everyone was so hyped up, and we literally had eye black for the stripes that we were earning. So, you know, those are the things that you remember, you know. And then obviously, you know, the great interception by Foye and the pressure by Matt Oplinger to steal that game, you know, it's the combination of the two things, really the passion that we have for one another that shows up on the field and allows us to make plays like that to put us in a position to, you know, have success. So, you know, those memories are the building blocks for the things that we've been able to accomplish, you know, hereafter.
2017 defense was full of veteran leaders that were teaching the younger dogs. What was it like playing with that group from 2017?
It was intense. You know, those guys were so determined, so, you know, focused on their goals. Had a lot of fifth-year seniors, very similarly to the situation we're coming into with Spencer Rymaczewski and, you know, Foye and a bunch of other guys that really just set the tone. It was very easy to just kind of fall in line. You know, they set a great example of exactly how we do things and with the attitude that we do them. And, you know, as a freshman, you're coming in with your own little agenda, but you quickly learn, you know, how we do things and what it means to be a Yale football player. So being under that tutelage for that season and to have the success that we did, again, it really just set precedent for how you want to go about being a Yale football player, because it's so much more than what happens on Saturdays. It's the things that are happening in the winter and the things that are occurring when people aren't watching.
This Yale-Harvard game was an opportunity to do a couple of things that hadn't been done in a long time. Yale had not beaten the team up north at home since 1999, nor had Yale won an outright Ivy League title since 1980. Was there any extra pressure going into this game?
That's kind of funny that you said that, because I was born in 1999, so that is a bit of a long time. But, you know, the pressure wasn't on the stake of the game, and it never is. It's all about really just trying to live up to the standard that folks had set. You know, for me, it was the last time that I was going to be taking the field with those seniors, with the Matt Oplingers, the Foye Oluwakins, the Spencer Rymaczewskis, the ones who really showed you what it really meant to give your all to the program and for the why that's on your helmet. So the pressure was more so to finish it the way that we wanted to. And, you know, playing a role in that, that was the pressure that I felt, because, you know, they kind of led with the intensity that it's all us. It starts and ends with what we do and how we go about situations. So it was all about just making sure I was being the best for the guys who were next to me.
You were involved in a couple of big plays that stand out to me from this game. The first one, Malcolm Dixon with the scoop and score in the second quarter.
It's kind of funny that you say that, because I was hoping that, you know, I would get my hands on that rock and, you know, hopefully take it to the end zone. But, you know, that game plan, it was really much a run and gun kind of game. You know, they had a lot of weapons that they were trying to get going with crossing routes and getting backs out into the flat. And that's kind of where we felt that we could match up, is, you know, running sideline to sideline. So when we had an opportunity to get a turnover, You know, it was all just trying to get on it and capitalize from it. So I was going for, you know, the bend at the knees, you know, scoop and pick. Malcolm, you know, kind of ran in there and grabbed it and took it to the house. But, you know, all's well that ends well, you know. But it was so exciting just to have everyone just, you know, flying to the ball, just trying to make as many plays as they could for each other. And I think that that was really the tone that we had set from the beginning. And, you know, having the opportunity to score a defensive touchdown in the biggest game at that point, it was really just a huge boost for us.
And the second play, which actually may be my favorite play from the entire game, a sack you had in the third quarter. You all were able to put so much pressure on the quarterback in this ballgame.
Pass rush from that season, it was really just, you know, pin your ears back and wreck the decision maker. I think that we had so many guys that were so tenacious and just so passionate about the game and that, you know, really truly believed that they couldn't be stopped, couldn't be blocked. And, you know, it really just came out on the film. And being around those guys and, you know, Coach McGowan calling up pressures that were able to get me free and, you know, have an opportunity to make a play, you just always dream for those opportunities. And, you know, again, the most exciting thing for me is making those plays around the guys that I look up to. So, you know, when Foye is making a sack and, you know, Oppy is bringing pressure on Viviano, you know, these are all things that I'm hyped up of and I'm excited for. So when I got a chance to make a play, I was looking for those older guys, you know, to get the kudos from them. It's all about, you know, setting the precedent for things to come. So it was a great feeling to be on the field for that.
That was Micah Awodiran, a rookie linebacker in this 2017 edition of The Game. Yale and Harvard continues.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Seems like the Olympics come sooner and sooner every year, which means every time, which means we're just getting older, Paul. Life goes faster the older you get, I think.
Yale back on offense, and Zane Dudek just scored a touchdown the last drive. So it's an NBC Super Bowl. A bunch of us going right from the Super Bowl Sunday. Monday to the flight over there.
Wow.
Begin the Winter Olympics. It's going to be a fun month.
You're living the dream, man. Living the dream.
Hanging out on Saturdays with Ross Tucker.
These guys are living the dream right here. How about a chance to get the first outright Ivy League title for Yale since 1980?
Since 1980. It's shared.
I was born in 79. I mean, that's 37 years. Unbelievable.
And they've had pieces of it. Rawlings out to Siragusa, just across the 41-yard line. They've had pieces of the title plenty of times, but just claiming it outright in the Ivy League is a special thing. There's Carm Koza, Hall of Fame legendary head coach. And that's Gary Fenzik behind him, by the way, who started for the Bears. Remember that back in 1985 as Carm celebrates? But he was the guy on the sideline back in 1980, the last outright championship.
Still has the Ivy League record with 10 Ivy League championships. Two active coaches right behind him, by the way.
Yeah.
Al Bagnoli, as well as Tim Murphy, both at 9. And neither one of them is going to get a piece of the championship this year because Yale's taking it all to themselves.
Yale's still throwing the ball, and Rawlings is sacked.
Stonehart, he is such a good player. Surprising decision to throw it there, and they wanted to keep moving the chains. But Stonehart, probably the best bull rusher in the Ivy League, gets Rawlings.
Look at the part of a bull rusher. That's an NFL-type body
Yeah, he's physically impressive. He really is. He's a good player.
Michelle Mosley started strong today with those three receptions on the field goal drive to start, but they've been punting away from him, kicking away from him. And has been limited offensively since that first drive. And got that one on a run. Didn't quite hit his average of almost 19 yards per return, but will put his offense in good field position. Let's take a look at our Subway Fresh Take, Ross.
Well, the fresh take's been the offensive line for Yale. They haven't run it as well, but look how much time Rawlings has had. Everyone will tell you it's the best O-line in the league. Frankly, it's probably not real close. They've done a better job on the run here in the second half, including the big hole for Rouse. Those guys are a big reason why Yale's about to win the Ivy League championship outright.
The conversation we had, I'd say a couple months ago, Ross, when it appeared that Yale was coming back and was going to be pretty good, I said, what's the deal with that bounce back? And right away you said, it's the best offensive line in the league.
Yeah, it's reminiscent of some of the great Harvard offensive line, frankly.
Which had been Harvard's calling call, calling card for so many of their good seasons.
Well, we asked Tony Reno, I asked him before the Brown game, I said, you know, what's offensively you're moving the ball so well, what's been the difference? He's like, oh, it's our O-line. I love our O-line. You got to love a head coach that says, I love our O-line. And both coaches mentioned that Yale, it feels like Yale is built in Harvard's image. You know, they are the best up front on both sides of the ball, which has typically been Harvard's M.O.
Viviano, it's his second series at quarterback, steps up and has this one picked off. Hayden Carlson, still going, down to the 35-yard line.
Late penalty there.
Senior from Glen Ellyn in Illinois with his third pick of his senior season.
What a cool way to end your football career, huh? Beating Harvard, home field, winning the Ivy League title outright, and getting an interception.
Back. Number 19. 10 yards from the end of the run. First down, Yale.
Picking up what we're talking about with Tony Reno, we see him right there. We see the pick now by Hayden Carlson. Good jump on it here, Ross.
He had an eye on Viviano the whole time and read exactly where Viviano wanted to go with the ball. What a career he's had. 266 tackles.
And nobody in the Ivy League right now has more. Heck of a career coming to a close. So Tony Reno not only has seven starters on defense. We talked to him during the week, Ross. He talked about the fact that he has a team that enjoys practice. As Dudek cuts it back, got a little room around the left side there, see if he can keep it in bounds. Gets down inside the 40-yard line. Now for more on Tony Reno, let's check in again with Carolyn.
Yeah, you know, Paul, just speaking with Tony, like you said, on the calls this week, one of the things he preaches to the kids is take care of your 20 square feet. That's been one of his mantras this year. Just keep it simple and do your job. And, Ross, you know, it's a simple message, but it's one that's been very successful, not just at this level, but also in the NFL. You know better than anybody. That's Bill Belichick's, you know, famous slogan, just do your job. Tony takes the same approach, simplifying everything, but just doing it well. And he says that that's why they've had so much success this season.
Ross, I think you have about 10 feet up here, maybe. Not quite 20.
Well, he talked about that. I mean, he said, you know, guys, the stuff we're into, it's a lot of the corny stuff. We focus a lot on relationships. Every year he takes the senior class down to Gettysburg to meet with General McChrystal. So the guys love each other. There's an investment in each other. He really feels like he's been able to turn the culture around. You see the team at Gettysburg. Every April, they do that with the seniors.
That's pretty cool.
Very cool. You see Tony's son right there in the middle? And it's paid dividends in a major way.
So they make that trip together, and what I was talking about with it, he told us they like practice, and I went to practice on Wednesday. I'm like, oh, my gosh, these guys actually are having a good time at a November practice. You've been on teams, even good ones, where, you know, practice is work.
Yeah.
And you don't always get the energy and enthusiasm, but he's getting that here this year, and a big reason why they're awfully close to being 9-1. Dudek, a little stiff arm in the backfield. And two times, penalty marker coming out there, but his acceleration and finishing of the runs is impressive, even on a day when the yards are coming tough for him.
You know, the last thing you want to do in these situations is have a penalty.
Holding. Offense, number 85. 10 yards from the previous spot. Second down.
This is essentially, Paul, 4-minute offense, and what you talk about here is you stay in bounds, two hands on the football, and no penalties, because you want the clock to keep moving when you're on offense. Those are the three tenets of four-minute offense.
Dudek still running hard, now at 20 carries, averaging 21 coming into this one the last three games, but only getting 51 yards so far. Hard-earned yards today. Ooh. And going down again in the backfield. It's been what his day has been all about so far. The Pierman making the stop.
There has been no quit in Harvard all day. I mean, they're running the ball. They've been very physical. I don't think you could ask much more of this defense, Paul, especially the front seven. Those guys, Hutton, Stonehart.
Well, Tony Reno told us during the week, he's like, the talent is still there. There is talent everywhere on both sides of the ball at Harvard. He was genuinely concerned during the week, as coaches can be during any game week. Dudek still on his feet. Wow!
Unbelievable. That is unbelievable. That is how you close out an Ivy League championship. That's the best run of the day. Let me see how many guys touch him. One, two, three, four, five, six. He's not down yet. Here comes seven, eight, nine, ten.
Wow.
I mean, he might have gotten 11 guys there. They might have taken 11 Harvard guys. Some of the guys hit him twice.
I think they had 12 men on the field, Ross.
That's unbelievable. They needed 12. They needed 20. What a player.
Wow. And you said he's heading home to Western PA tomorrow?
Yeah, that's what the coaches said. He played for Armstrong High School. He's from Katanning, out in the Whipple, District 7, Pittsburgh. And he is all football, man. I mean, he is. Coach Reno was telling us he fumbled in the Penn game. And Coach Reno's watching the defense, and he feels somebody tugging on him. And he's thinking, turns around, and it's Zane Dudek. And he says, Coach, I'll never do that again. Tony said, okay. Sounds good to me.
We're going to have a whole lot of carries in the next 3 years here. Some of the upperclassmen coming off the field.
Boy, you got to feel so good for the seniors for Yale. They did a lot of losing, Paul. They did a lot of losing the last few years.
Last year they did.
Yeah.
They were 3-7 last year. Bulldogs have also made a quarterback change. It's Andrew Johnson in, spelling Kurt Rawlings. The coaches can get themselves worried pretty much at any point in the game, but even Tony has to be feeling that it's awfully close, almost at the 2-minute mark to that outright conference championship. And last year they played the conference champions, the teams that shared it in Penn and also Princeton.
Right.
Combined score 73-10 against those two teams.
Yeah, I don't know if they're here, Paul, if they don't beat Harvard in this game a year ago. It just was such a springboard for them.
Andrew Johnson with the keep.
And there is going to be some celebrating done in New Haven tonight. It's a long time coming. Did Harvard call timeout?
It was a timeout call. Tony Reno, part coaching, part enjoying the moment there with his Yale Bulldogs about to become the Ivy League champs. Thank you. TIAA presents the Ivy League Game of the Week, and it is the game. Harvard, Yale, Yale in control. Here's what else is happening around the Ivy League. And we came on the air talking about how Columbia and Dartmouth paying close attention to what's happening here because they could share the Ivy League crown if they won and Yale lost. But Yale well on its way to a victory, a commanding victory that will give them the conference title all by themselves. See Princeton coming back. Another back and forth game for the Tigers.
Yeah, they've lost every close game they've been in. I mean, they've got five wins, but their four losses all close games.
Still Dudek in, fighting for extra yardage. New quarterback in is Tom Stewart. Moments ago. It's got to be cold.
So
extra
cold.
Cold when it's 39.
So cold. Purple's my favorite, by the way. I would have dumped like lemon lime on them. Purple's legit good.
You would have saved that, huh? What a feeling on the sideline. The last time you're on the field, a win over your biggest rival gives you the conference championship.
His sixth year here. And you think about all the time these guys put in, these coaches. It's no different for them than it is at Michigan, Ohio State, anywhere.
Viviano finds Taylor. Good connection there. Out across midfield. Got to think Harvard will be back after a season like this. They're so used to having 7, 8, 9 wins.
A lot of injuries. They lost a lot of guys, but they'll be getting a whole lot back. You're right. You won't keep the Crimson down for long, that's for sure.
So if Princeton hangs on to win that game, and right now they're up 7, your MVP vote, Zane Dudek or Chad Knopf, the Princeton quarterback? Ooh. Looking for Taylor again, falls incomplete.
You know, I think if it were the NFL and there was like a most outstanding offensive player, I think Knopf would probably get it. But if we're talking value, I think frankly, you got to win more games than Princeton has for it to be Knopf. I think it'll either be Dudek or Rawlings. I'll be curious to see for the ASA Bushnell Cup. You know, there's 2 offensive finalists and 2 defensive finalists. My guess it'll be Knopf and Dudek, although it could be Rawlings too. Rawlings has been awfully good when they need him to, especially in these last 2 games as well.
Rawlings done a great job at taking care of the football. Dudek running it as well. He come underneath. It'll be Harvard first down. And Joe Viviano, the senior quarterback, leading the way.
I think Tim Murphy really wants a touchdown for a lot of different reasons. Be good for Joe Viviano, his last football game of his life, and also they hadn't gotten shut out since 1998. I don't think he wants to have back-to-back shutouts.
And shut out of the end zone, that is, yeah.
Correct. No touchdowns.
And it was just late in the second half that they went over 100 yards of total offense. Pushing it to the end zone, and it's intercepted.
Freshman. Deontay Henson. They got some good freshmen too, Paul. Doing it right there in the student section. I would totally just jump up into that student section right there. I would do the Lambo leap. They're doing it.
A perfect way to end there for the Yale defense.
They'll be able to just take a knee. What a play. Wow. Deontay Henson, only a freshman, going up and climbing the ladder. They lose 3 DBs, seniors, but they got guys like Henson coming back. Tony Reno is a recruiter. You see the students love it.
And you're starting out with your sophomore quarterback. He'll be back. Zane Dudek will come back. First and foremost, an offseason to enjoy not just a win over Harvard, but an outright conference title.
Wow.
Think about all that's changed for Yale. Harvard just called timeout.
Second timeout, 30 seconds.
Can't say I quite understand that one.
Can't take him with you.
I guess. You know what? I mean, you see the huddle down there for Harvard. Maybe the coaches just wanted to say one more thing. to the Yale players, to the Harvard players. Maybe, hey, be a sportsman here. Nothing out of character for us, just making sure that they do the right thing here.
Maybe get some seniors in. But 1 year ago, Ross, before this game in Cambridge, Yale was 2-7. 2-7, they had the big win at Harvard, springboard into the offseason. They get settled at quarterback.
Wow, he used his last timeout. Can't say I understand that ball. I mean, it's 24-3. And what it does is it kind of hurts the excitement and the buildup for Yale celebration. I mean, the game is over. That would be one that I would ask Coach Murphy about after the game if we spoke to him.
You suppose that's the motivation?
No. I think he just wants to talk to his guys and I guess tell them how he feels about them, but he can tell them that on the last timeout or after the game. You know, one of the things that's unique about this game is most of the crowd will storm the field after the game when the game's played here at the Yale Bowl. So this whole crowd will be filled with people. The whole field, I should say, will be filled with people. And so, you know, you might not get a chance to talk to them after the game. They're going to force Yale to have to punt, I guess. Awfully anticlimactic,
right? As we count down the final seconds here, I can point out that Yale undefeated at home, Ross, and outscoring their opponents at home this year by 122 points.
I'll give you one that's even crazier.
Let me have.
They've allowed 13 points in their last three home games. Now with the field goal here, they've allowed 16 points in the last three home games. And one of those was a total garbage time touchdown by Brown. I mean,
timeouts won't stop it now. Yale fans.
I guess they'll get a delay game and have to punt it away. Nothing like a game-ending punt.
First timeout. 30 seconds.
You know, they could just have Rawlings run around a little bit and take a knee.
Right?
Imagine if he gets hurt or something.
Run around and take a knee, and then he could keep the game ball. The Harvard trail in this game, 3-0, but as the scoreboard shows you right there, it's been all Bulldogs since soon as that second quarter started.
I guess the flip side is if you're the Yale guys, why not have even more time to enjoy this, let it all soak in. You see a bunch of the seniors there, pretty much all the guys you see there. Oplinger, Carlson, Kapachi Tyler, Rimashevsky, Harubin. It's the last time they'll play college football. Several of them hoping to get shots at the next level, but what a special moment.
Can you imagine you knock off Harvard, you clinch the outright crown, you keep the Crimson out of the end zone. If you're one of those seven starting defenders that's a senior for Yale, you just can't write it up any better.
And you know, we're talking about forever. You know, you're talking about reunions 10 years from now when they celebrate it, 20 years. I mean, you're marking history here in this league. They put 6 seconds back up. Is this a pooch kick by Rawlings, or does he run around?
Running around. And that's how it ends for the first time since 1980. The Bulldogs are the outright conference champs. One season ends in celebration. The Ivy League crown is all theirs.
What an awesome scene. This is what college football is all about.
remember, Harvard had won seven consecutive times here at the Yale Bowl, too.
Man, people are just pouring out onto the field. Good luck finding your mom or your buddy.
Carolyn Mano is down there, and somehow she found Tony Reno. Carolyn, take it away.
I know, it's like, where's Waldo out here? But I managed to track down the man of the hour. Congratulations. What does it mean to have this outright title for the first time since 1980?
Well, so proud of this team. You know, they've been able to continue to embrace every day, embrace the week, and focus on opponents every week, week in and week out. You know, we had a heartbreak at Dartmouth, but the kids responded, and it really helped us improve this season. So just really proud of our seniors and our team.
One of the things you preach is about setting a standard. You now have two consecutive wins in this game. How far does that go in building your future with this program?
Well, I think it shows where we are on the map, Yale football is. But, you know, every year is a new year. So, your team's going to form an identity starting tomorrow, and we got to get going on Team 146 tomorrow.
How much respect do you have for Justice Shelton Mosley and Harvard's front seven and the way that they fought to the end today?
Well, you know, Harvard's got a great team, and they have talent. They're a very talented football team, probably the most talented in the league. And, Justice Shelton Mosley is the most explosive player in the league. So the less times he touches the ball, the better it is for us.
You have so many seniors. You have the trenches that are just filled with talent. What can you say about the players that you have on this squad, the way that they appreciate each other, and how much they love this game?
Well, that's one of the most important things that we have here. I mean, guys love playing together. Guys love playing football. You know, it's been a joy to coach these guys all season long just because of that, because of their sheer joy of playing together. And the relationships these guys built for the full year has been incredible. I mean, stuff that'll last a lifetime.
Coach, congratulations.
Thank you.
Carolyn, Tony, thank you. That's two wins in a row over Harvard, and this one clinches that Ivy League crown. They keep it all to themselves. 24-hour rule, I guess, is in effect. He said tomorrow they start forming the personality of next year's team.
You know what? They will. They will. Knowing Tony Reno, they probably will. What a terrific performance. You know what, Paul? They deserved it. They were the best team all year. They were the best team today. They have the most talent. I disagree with Coach Reno. I think Yale has the most talent. They stayed the healthiest. They played the best. They have the most experience. And all those things should go together to give you a 9-1 Ivy League championship.
Bulldogs sitting atop the Ivy League, 9-1 overall, and the only team with just one loss. A 1-point loss to Dartmouth, but 6-1, looking awfully good there for the Bulldogs. The celebration continues inside the Yale Bowl. Guarantee you those seniors don't want to go in and take those pads off for that final time.
No.
Not feeling cold at all.
I think you'd find me on this field tonight if I were one of them. I would not want to leave here for a long, long time.
Same team that was 2-7 prior to last year's game against Harvard. Celebrating the dominating win against the Crimson here today. All the more impressive, Ross, they did it in such controlling fashion with Zane Dudek, who really is the guy who makes this thing go on offense. Only 25 carries for 64 yards. We'll continue here inside the Yale Bowl. Kurt Rawlings and the Bulldogs enjoying the conference title they don't have to share with anyone. Celebration inside the Yale Bowl not dying down anytime soon. The Bulldogs, the coaches, their fans celebrating not only a 21-point victory, but a conference championship that's all theirs for the first time in 37 years. Plenty of good plays went into this one, and the celebration on the field right now. Offense and defense, we could only pick one for the play of the game, Ross.
Well, I think it was pretty clearly the missed pitch from Harvard here. Jake Smith trying to get it to his fellow freshman, Aaron Champlin. Malcolm Dixon, the corner for Yale, picks it up, and it was 7-3 at that point. It was a game, and game kind of slipped away at that point right there. Cannot make mistakes like that against the better team, quite frankly.
And in the next series, they created a turnover on the similar kind of play with the option pitch that went awry. And it was all Yale from that point. Back to the beginning of the game, remember, Ross, that Harvard went right down the field. Smith to Shelton Mosley a series of times. Couldn't put it in the end zone, but
first and goal inside the five to not get a touchdown after that.
That was three consecutive plays with the Yale front seven. Somebody, usually a couple of somebodies in the backfield, making a play to push it back and force that field goal. And it took him until the second quarter to put points on the board. The Rawlings to J.P. Schofield, 45-yarder that led to the Rawlings to Schofield fade for the touchdown. And then that play we just saw, Malcolm Dixon with the scoop and score. That came shortly after, and the Harvard offense just struggled mightily throughout, Ross. They didn't score a touchdown last week or this week. And it was deep in the second half until they had over 100 yards of total offense.
I think it's awesome that they let everybody come on the field, by the way. You know, let everybody feel like they're part of it.
Nobody rushing them off?
No, I mean, it's just let's all enjoy it together. I think there should be more of this, quite frankly, in college football. Especially with all the fake turf fields, you're not really hurting the field. Yale actually has real grass, but this is the last game anyway.
They do have a lot of security protecting the goalposts. I don't know if you're old enough to remember when the goalposts used to come down.
Yes.
After big wins.
Yeah, I remember that. Just a sea of blue.
Dominating home schedule for Yale, 5-0 at the Yale Bowl this season. I believe Carolyn Mano is down there somewhere. Carolyn, are you with us?
Yeah, hey, I'm here with Earl Chisholm, who's a senior here at Yale. Oh, sorry, just to run out of our way. And a couple of fans are getting in the way. We're trying to wrangle everybody together. Earl, as a senior, congratulations on this win. How would you describe this particular rivalry and what it means for this group of seniors?
Well, this group of seniors has done a lot of work, you know, our past 4 years here. And just to end it this way against our rival has been just incredible. And just love this group of guys, and I know we're going to carry this for the rest of our lives.
What do you think this win does to add to the legacy that head coach Tony Reno is trying to establish with this team?
I mean, just the length of time since it's been we've had a championship, and then outright championship, it just kind of speaks for itself. I mean, it's been so long, and just to see it all culminate like this, it's just incredible.
You know, Tony Reno talks a lot about relationships, players and players, coaches and players, coaches and coaches, and the standard that he's trying to set for this team. How proud are you to play a role in that and to be a part of what could be described as a family here?
It's been incredibly humbling, and I mean, I have a group of brothers, 107 guys deep, coaches. I mean, it's just been incredible just being in this ride and having a role like that. It's incredible. It's an unreal feeling, definitely.
Congratulations to you.
Thank you.
Paul?
Carolyn, thank you very much. Nice job working your way around down that, all that crowd down there and the celebration. Ross, final thoughts on what you saw from Yale, not just today, but this entire conference championship season.
Well, they are very, very deserving champions. They've got the best team. They've showed it all year long, and a great year for the Ivy League. You know, Columbia will be in second place, maybe tied with Dartmouth, but bunch of teams have been able to turn it around this year. You know, at one point, Coach Estes said that the Ivy League's flipped upside down with some of the teams at the top. And I think that's great for the league, great for any league, quite frankly, when you have some fresh blood at the top.
It's been a big part of the excitement all season long here, the parity. And the teams coming back to the top, like you mentioned, that just a year ago were really struggling and toward the bottom.
And I don't think Yale's going away anytime soon. They lose a lot, but they got a bunch of kids back also.
Ross, good season. Absolutely, spend time with you.
Awesome.
Always a fun time. Final score here inside the Yale Bowl for the game. Yale, from the second quarter on, dominated. They win 24-3, and with it, they win the outright conference title. Next college football for us is the Bayou Classic, Southern and Grambling. That's November 25th, coming up next Saturday. Thanks for being with us. So long from New Haven.